Bonjour, mesdames, messieurs. C'est un réel plaisir d'ouvrir cette conférence qui est donnée à l'occasion du 20e anniversaire de la Fondation Banque de France. 20 ans, ce n'est pas seulement un bel âge, c'est aussi un âge important, celui où tout est possible. Et nous accueillons pour le célébrer des intervenants de renom, dont certains sont anglophones. C'est la raison pour laquelle je vais poursuivre en anglais, ce qui ne déplaira peut-être pas une partie du public. So, ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome. I now switch to English, given the international audience and speakers we are very lucky to have today. I would like first to express the great pleasure I have to open this conference for the 20th anniversary of the Banque de France Foundation for Monetary Banking and Financial Economic Research. And I extend a very warm welcome to the prominent speakers who made us the honor of joining us today. Yann Algan from Sciences Po in Paris, Luigi Zingales, from the University of Chicago Booth School of Business, and all our chairs and discussants who also are renowned economists in their respective fields. A few words about the topic of this conference now. The idea of this conference is to take a step back and some time to reflect on monetary and financial research in general and its impact on policies and on society. We will thus evoke the role of economics and economists within our society. We have two provocative papers, which will be discussed today, and they provide a very nice opportunity for such a discussion. They both point out several concerns about economic research and finance. They highlight the tendencies of economies to be self-referential and analyze how the social perception of the finance industry is largely negative nowadays, and the more so since the financial crisis. In that respect, the paper focuses on the United States, but there is little doubt that France probably is no exception to that rule either. After the 2007-2008 crisis, some first steps have been taken to change incentives in the financial industry, and even more should be done in that direction in the coming years. At the same time, economists should also adopt a more critical view on the financial industry practices and judge them as impartially as possible. But what can we say about economists themselves? Are they really too self-referential? And do they tend to overestimate their role in society? On a personal note, as a policymaker and central banker, I do believe it is possible that central bank governors may pay the cost to the so-called superiority of economists, for instance, when they are too sure of their econometric models. Now, how will we proceed in this conference today? In-depth discussion of papers will be left to participants. However, I would like to mention the potential role that the Foundation can play to help address some important issues. First, economic analysis is definitely needed in order to sharpen policymakers' understanding of the world. At the same time, policymakers should continuously challenge the alleged superiority of economists with the complexity of the real world. Second, actions need to be taken to get academia more involved in policymaking, to bring the discipline of theory-based analysis to the policy debates. That implies certainly a better access to governmental data for academic researchers to enable them to conduct independent and rigorous research and expose their results to policymakers and the general public, who should listen to them in return, of course. Well, I hope this is no wishful thinking, and I will now leave the floor to our distinguished speakers. Thank you very much for your attendance today.
Bonjour à tous. Hi, everybody. It's a great pleasure for me to be here today. I'd like to thank the organizer, especially Louis, and myself for putting myself in front of you this morning. With no further ado, so we took a little risk this morning in the program, this step back, thinking about economists, as insightful as they think they are. So we take a little bit of risk with this provocative paper by Yann Algan, but still, you know, in the group of courses, we invited the economist to speak, so hopefully he's not going to be too severe with himself. Yann, if you want to take the floor and tell us about the paper.
Thanks a lot for the invitation. I'm really glad to be here. Before starting to talk, I just want to really thank, obviously, all the organizers for this invitation. I would like also to thank more generally the Banque de France and Fondation for all their investment in research. I know that they have supported a lot different research establishments like Sciences Po, but also more broadly, young researcher, and so we owe you a lot. So let me start by presenting this paper, The Superiority of Economics, that has been published in the Journal of Economic Perspective. So let me just start that I'm really, this is symptomatic of the superiority of economists, the way I will present this paper, because I have two co-authors, Marion Fourcade, a sociologist from Berkeley, and Étienne Ollion, a sociologist from Université de Strasbourg. And to tell you the truth, they have done all the job, but I'm the one who presents the paper. And I'm not just kidding, they deserve a lot of credit. Marion Fourcade has published wonderful books on the relationship between economics and society, and Étienne Ollion is one of the most well-known specialists also in France in this literature. So the motivation of this paper has to do, to a certain extent, with this picture. A nice cartoon that The Economist has done to illustrate our paper, with the power of self-confidence, with economists who actually portray themselves at the top. And this is quite true. When you look at the ranking of the different disciplines, it seems that there is an implicit or explicit picking order, and economists dominate everything. They are obviously, they attract better students, they are better paid, but they present themselves in general at the top. I just give you two examples. The first one from students' surveys, typically Colander in a survey among grad students found that 77% of econ students in elite grad programs will agree with the fact that economics is the most scientific of all the social sciences, while in other social sciences, in general, grad students will say that they are equally scientific. And we, actually, when we published this paper, a lot of young economists on Econ Job Rumors, I don't know if you know this website, this is a website where young students who are looking for a job exchange a lot of news, were really outraged against our paper, and so they say, but obviously we are at the top, we are the best, and in general sociologists play around with big important ideas without too much effort or rigor. And this is not, this common belief is also shared by a lot of academics, and typically Freeman in a well-known paper will declare sociologists and political scientists have less powerful analytical tools and know less than we do, or so we believe. And even Claudia Shan, making fun of our paper, but in a really gentle way, when she goes to gym, so I don't know if you can read here, that my trainer told me that I should feel much more superior when I go to gym. And it's quite simple. If you want to really distinguish economists compared to other people, just go on the web page. So I'm sorry, I haven't looked at your web page before making the talk. You have time to change still the picture, but If you look at the webpage of The Economist, in the way they portray themselves, you will see a picture of themselves, in general, alone, in the top of a mountain, dominating the world. And if you are not a climber, I mean, don't wish to be an economist. And this is really, it stands in sharp contrast with how other social scientists present themselves. So what will we do? And they think they are at the top, and they might think so rightly, since they are really, to a certain extent, ubiquitous. They are present everywhere, in all the medias, in government agencies, in corporations, in Department of Justice, at Banque de France, but which is much more natural. And I just give you a hint of this ubiquity of economists with the rise of the citation of economists. So during the 20th century, in the New York Times. So what you see here is the number, the percentage of times the New York Times, the Times, will cite economists as opposed to historians, sociologists, and things like that. And what is really striking is that it used to be the case that psychologists or historians will actually be much more often cited than economists. And then there's really a rise of economists, and the financial crisis doesn't change much this ranking. And when you think about the French situation, this is also true. When you look at the most dominant figure, there was at the beginning historians like Braudel, and then they have been followed by philosophers like Foucault or Sartre, and now economists are here to present this kind of papers. Okay, I just want as a motivation to say one word. Even if they are better paid, they are ubiquitous, in general, they think that this is because they are smarter, but at the end of the day, this science is still a social construction. And just to give you a flavor of this social construction, we represent here the percentage of doctorates awarded to women in selected disciplines, and we still show that this discipline is really male-dominated. Here you have, really in black, in dark black, the share of the percentage of doctorate in economics, which rank well below all the other social sciences. So it should, to a certain extent, alarm us and recall us that this is still a social construction. So what we will try to do in this paper, first, is to document the shifting relationship of economics to other social sciences, and then provide an explanation for this unique position, its consequences, and its peril. And I just want to mention one limit of this paper, or a note on the method. We will really focus on US economists, and we will both gather original database with especially from extensive analysis of top journal, and we'll try to combine existing survey and public databases. Okay, so let me say a word first about insularity. What really struck us with Marion and Etienne is the big shifting of economists apart from other social sciences after the World War II period, okay? Especially, they leave aside their original matrix with sociology or history to turn to natural sciences. And this is really true when you ask economists themselves how they would define and with whom they will actually have engaged in interdisciplinary dialogue. And this is also the case when you look at citation. Let's have a look first at the belief of economists that I represent here from a survey by Gross and Simons with a sample of professionals in different departments, in different fields, in economics, sociology, political science, psychology, history, finance. And they were asked, in general, do you think that interdisciplinary knowledge is better than knowledge obtained by a single discipline? And as you can see, economists stand in sharp contrast compared to other disciplines, where no more than actually 40% would agree that interdisciplinary is better, while in psychology, sociology, or political science, there will be an overwhelming majority. And then, when you turn to citations themselves, and you look at how the different disciplines cite each other, you still find a much more pronounced insularity of economics compared to other social sciences. Here on the left side, we report a table from Jacobson, where we look at the within-field citation in the different disciplines. Okay? And what you can see that in economics, 81% of the citations are within the field of economics, while in all the other disciplines, obviously, there is a kind of insularity, but they are much more open to other fields. And this is the same thing when we have looked with Marion and Etienne with our own calculation from the Web of Sciences at the citation patterns between the top journals. What you can see here is that typically the American Political Science Review will cite more than 5 times the top 25 economic journal, as the American Economic Review will cite the top 25 political science journal. So there is really a kind of asymmetry. Obviously, you might think that those numbers are biased downward, especially because of the role of books in other disciplines, but it is not just a methodological artifact. As you can see here, we look at the prominent figures who are engaged in the interdisciplinary dialogue. And let's take Pierre Bourdieu. Pierre Bourdieu is one of the most cited sociologists and the most cited sociologists in the US. He reaped 60 mentions in the American Sociology Review, but he will receive only one citation in the American Economic Review. And maybe this is due to you, Luigi. Now, if you compare with Gary Becker obviously is present in the AER, but he will reap 41 citation in the American Sociology Review. And this is exactly, you see exactly the same asymmetry for other top authors. Typically, Heckman will receive 25 mentions in the American Sociology Review, while Max Weber will receive only 4 mentions in the AER. So there is a strong asymmetry in the citation patterns, a strong and a higher insularity of economics compared to other social sciences, and the question is why. What we try to say with Marion and Etienne in this paper is that they might have, you might have 2 main explanations. The first one is just the fact that they come from different epistemological culture, or they have grown differently and apart of each other, with economists having a much higher focus on preferences and individual maximization or individual decision, while in other disciplines, the preferences are shaped by social preferences. And to a certain extent, some of you will tell me that there has been a growing interest of economics with other disciplines, especially psychology, with experimental economics, and now a few Nobel Prizes come from the from psychology. But to a certain extent, it's not an accident that economists feel much more engaged with psychology to the extent that we really start from the same assumption of individual decision or individual cognition. Now, the second argument that Marion, Etienne, and I actually put forward is the high scientific claims linked to the use of formal method. The main reason why both students and academics are quite dismissive compared to other science comes from the fact that economists really think that they master quantitative tools and others don't. This is true when you look at Lazier in a quite naive way in his famous economic imperialism paper in the CUGE, who will say that the ascension of economics results from the fact that our discipline has a rigorous language that allows complicated concepts to be written in relatively simple abstract terms. And let me cite, it's quite long, but I can't resist to cite this this citation from an anonymous, well-known economist interviewed by Marion Fourcade. And what this economist will say is, if you don't follow certain rules, you are not an economist. So that means you should derive the way people behave from strict maximization theory. The opposite will be arguing. You are not allowed to do that. There is a world for it. People say that's anecdotal. Oh my God, that's the end of you if people have said you are anecdotal. And another thing is what modern people say. The modern thing is it's not identified. Gone. When your causality is not identified, that's the end of you. It rings any bell? It sounds familiar, no? So how painful it is when people say it's anecdotal and not identified, and these kind of things will much be less frequent in other social sciences. The second distinctive feature of economics compared to the other social sciences is really the vertical or the sense of hierarchy in their organization. This is true when you look at the consensus. For sure, economists have more consensus, and whatever the potential political or ideological divide between economists, you can be sure that when they have to fight against others, they will really group together. Okay, and this is actually how, in all economic departments, we are able to get more position at the expense of other departments. I'll just give you an example. This higher consensus can be found in the training. All the PhD curriculum or the textbook are much more uniform. There is nothing like a Moncu or a Blanchard book in sociology, okay, or in other or in political sciences. There's a much higher consensus in how to get a job and how to rank the different departments or the top, you know, the superstar of the job market. And we have a consensual way of ranking people. There's nothing like REPEC in other social sciences. You know this, for you of us who are not familiar, this is either when you are not André Schleifer, this is the nightmare of all economists. In early, so the fourth or the fifth of every month, the world stops turning around and moving, and economists look at their ranking, okay? And when, oh my gosh, this time, once again, André is still number one. Me, I don't rank myself here. But you will never have this kind of clear ranking of status in other disciplines. There's more control also in the, actually, in the organization of the disciplines. And I just give you two examples. The first one has to do in a really simple way when you look at the bylaws of the different organizations or at the composition of the members of the Executive Council of the American Economic Association, the American Political Science Association, or the American Sociological Association. And so in DAC, what you can see is that around 80% of the composition of the American Economic Association is made up of precisely members coming from the top five departments. While in other disciplines, the composition is much more diverse and much more based on grassroots representations. Okay, so it's just an illustration of the difference in organization and the much higher vertical structure of economists. This is also true in the way you get published. If you just look at the asymmetry or the control of publication by top departments, this might still raise some challenges or some questions. I'll just give you an example by comparing the differences in the department affiliation of from people who publish in the top five sociology department or from the top five economic department. So what we have computed here is the following number. The top five sociology department will account for 22.3% of all authors published in the American Sociology, American Journal of Sociology. When you look at the top five economic department, it will account for 28% of all authors in the GPE and a high rocketing 37% in the CUGE. And when you look at the PhD origins, you will find that 35% having made the PhD from a top five sociology department will publish in the American Journal of Sociology, but 57% from the top five econ department will publish in the CUGE. So obviously you might have a lot of rationale by saying, so maybe the best students will go precisely to Harvard in the econ department, and this is why the likelihood to be published is much higher. We don't dispute this with Marion and Etienne, but still the strong in-house and home bias is much more pronounced in economics compared to sociology. Typically, the American Journal of Sociology is in-house in Chicago, and what you can see is that coming from Chicago give you less advantage of being published compared to students coming from Harvard in sociology. So this in-house bias or home bias is much more pronounced in economics compared to sociology or other social sciences. So far, what we have said is that the economics have grown quite apart from other social sciences. They have also another organization, especially a much more vertical and hierarchical organization compared to other social sciences. Now, still, they do engage with other disciplines. But when they engage with other disciplines, it's in a really different way compared to other social disciplines. First, this is true when you look at citations, and who you cite says a lot about who you are. What we do here is that we represent the percentage of citations since post-World War II, so of outfield citation from the top five journals in economics to different disciplines, so finance, statistics, business, mathematics, and so on. What you can see, or maybe you can see nothing, but I will try to explain this in words, is that it used to be the case that math, with an M here, and statistics really dominated the outfield citation from economic journal. Okay, so it was really pronounced, and you remember it was the times where people were showing their muscles by doing game theory and kind of things. Now, economic theory is much less present in the publication, but you can see a steady rise of outfield publication towards finance. And finance now is the big thing in economics, not only in terms of citation, but also in terms of organization. Let's give us some example. First, the institutional rise of finance can be seen in the teaching and research organization of the department. Typically, in 2010, you had 549 econ PhD, who would teach in the top 20 business schools, and just 100 more PhD economists teaching in econ department. So it's more or less half-half in the two different departments. Similarly, there's a substantial share of Nobel Prize now teaching in business school, and there's a steady rise in the share of economists affiliated with business school who are publishing in the AER, the figure reaching 18% in the 2000 compared to a really low 3% in the 50s. And this actually shift of econ department or econ publication to finance is not innocuous. I will let Luigi say a word about that. But in a spectacular paper in 2013, what Luigi shows is that there is something related with the capture of economics by business interest. Economic articles are significantly less likely to be positive on the level of executive compensation and significantly more likely to be negative when none of the authors worked in the business schools. Okay, so there is an orientation of what you claim depending on your affiliation. Let us conclude with two sections. The first one is, on top of their insularity and difference in organization, the economists, including myself, really tend to have a life on their own. This is true, obviously, in terms of economic status, in terms of income. What we show here, what we have computed with Marion and Etienne is the Bureau of Labor Force Statistics, is the annual median and 19th percentile wages in selected disciplines. And let's look at the top 10 6% of economists who are the most well paid. These, so on average, they will earn $160,000, which is by way far above what you will earn from a top department in sociology or in literature or in literature. And when you compare the different disciplines, actually economists will outperform even physics, okay, physicians. They are with computational sciences, they are really the most well paid of the different disciplines. But economists do distinguish themselves also in their social habitus. This is true in terms of preferences. There's been an abundant literature showing that typically the level of cooperation of young economists will differ compared to other social scientists. Typically, when they are asked to play trust game or voluntary charity contribution, they will contribute much less to the public good compared to students enrolled in sociology, literature, or other social disciplines. We don't know if it's really self-selection or due to our curriculum, but still, the evidence is there. We also have differences in our political beliefs. Still, we exploit the Gross and Simons survey on the American professionals, where they are asked different social attitudes and political attitudes. One of the questions is, do you think that government should work to reduce income differences between rich and poor? And in general, the economist will say much less frequently than the government should intervene compared to other social sciences. So obviously, when you look at the political spectrum, economists tend to be more on the left compared to the median American voter, but still much more at the right of all the other social sciences. And this is a particular true when you ask them, do you think that African Americans don't have the motivation to pull themselves out of poverty? Psychologists will say 0%. 0% of psychologists will tend to think this is true. But around 60% of economists will agree with this kind of sentence. And what is really striking is that we do have different beliefs, but we also have different beliefs compared to the Main Street guy, okay, or to the typical voter in the US, in our dearest ideas. We will be, there is a huge consensus in economics, for instance, to think that free trade will increase efficiency. But in general, Americans would say that barring Americans, this is the right thing to do. In the same way, economists would think that imposing taxes is much more efficient than having a strong regulation on the quantity for carbon emissions. But this is really far from what typical Americans would think. So you will tell me that it may be a good news that economists are not involved in populism and they don't have to think like the typical median voter. But still, what is really striking is that economists are not only experts, but they really want to convince people. And we want to conclude this paper and this presentation with this, we think, real specificity of economists that we call the fixed-it culture. In a simple way, the growing social distance of economists from the public at large will not be a problem in itself if economists were not making their mission precisely to maximize the welfare of all the population. And this is exactly what they pretend to do. This is what we call the fixed-it culture. In history of sciences, obviously, economists have always been portrayed as the prince of the king. But even in the way we conceive our intervention, from the social planner to now the randomized experiment by Esther Duflo or the new nudge literature on how to fix with simple psychological tweets the behavior of people, or asking Olivier Blanchard on how to solve the world. As economists, we all have done the job because we wanted at some point to change the world. And when you really try to understand why economists are really maybe much more ubiquitous compared to other social scientists, and why, to a certain extent, even after the financial crisis, both government agencies, consultancies want economists to step in, it's not necessarily because we, as economists, are better in terms of mastering quantitative tools. It's really because we combine, obviously, quantitative tools, but with this fixed culture, this willingness to change things. Typically, if you ask a political scientist, even in homeland security, okay, where the political scientists should have a big value added compared to economists because they will be able to speak indigenous language and things like that. But now, even in the homeland security department, they will recruit young PhD students from the MIT to create an independent central bank in Afghanistan, in Ukraine. If you ask political scientists to go there, they will shy away. They will say, oh my God, if I actually move from minus 10 to plus 10 on my scale of freedom in this country, maybe I will do more harm than actually helping these people. So economists are really, and themselves, they tend to describe primarily as scientist or intellectual. And when you ask sociologists in general how they will describe themselves, they will say, as scientists too, but they also add as social critics. So maybe this is necessity that becomes virtue, but it really shows the difference between how the way people define themselves. And to conclude this presentation, what will make really the distinction of economists compared to the other social sciences is precisely because they define as a transformative force. We not just describe the world, we want to change the world. And when markets do not exist and we think that those markets should actually increase the welfare of people or make reality more aligned with our own theory, we create this market. And this is typically what we have done with the option and futures market, as analyzed by McKinsey. So as a conclusion, as we'll say that this is not a critique on economics, but it's just a way to provide a mirror on our assumption and on the way we define ourselves. But still, obviously, by being a transformative force, we are much more ubiquitous compared to the other social sciences, but it has some perils. This is also what raises some mockery when we actually predict things that never happen, or the reverse is also true. And let me just conclude by mentioning Keynes. If economists could manage to get themselves thought of as humble, competent people on a level with dentists, that would be splendid. And when you compare economists with other social scientists, maybe this is not the good comparison. The real guy with whom economists should be compared is with doctors. But when doctors actually have the wrong medicine and the wrong pill, he should be really humble. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Yann. This was a very nice presentation and very much thought-provoking. So when Mrs. Le Laurier decided that this should be the first paper on the program this morning, she made it very clear that we needed to have discussions with very open minds, and minds get open through experience. And the first speaker indeed has met very different things, and not only economics in his professional life. Currently, he's professor at the EUI, only from Pompeo Fabra. He's a member of very prestigious professional associations such as CPR and ZNBR. And actually, a few years back, he was also Secretary of State for Science and Technology in the Spanish government. So Ramon, the floor is yours to comment on this very nice paper.
Thank you. First of all, let me say that I absolutely agree with Jan on what he said about the acknowledgement, so I don't have to repeat that. This paper raises a very important question. Economists, are they social scientists or social crooks? And then goes on to other questions. If they are social scientists, why are they so antisocial with their peers? Why do they live in isolation? If they live in isolation, why do they unfollow San Francesco and live in meditation? Why are they so hierarchical and elitist and inward-looking and competitive? If they are hierarchical and elitist, are they dynamic, as they claim? If they are inward-looking and competitive, is this good for them? If they are social scientists, why are they becoming so attracted by the world of finance? If they live in isolation, why are they so influential? If they are elitist and assertive and inward-looking and competitive, why are they asking themselves all these questions? So let me address some of these questions, not all, living in isolation. Sciences and engineering. All the sciences have a lot of work to understand. Engineers have problems to solve. Science provides foundations and new tools to engineers. Engineers can provide new inputs and questions to scientists. So we have natural science have their engineering. They look up energy sources. Life sciences have medicine and bioengineering. They have to solve cancer and many problems. Social science, we have socioeconomic policies. But then we talk about avoiding crisis, allocation of spectrum bands, creating new banking unions. This paper puts economics mostly within the social science, although at the end said we should be compared to dentists. And I like this then, because when you look at more, not from the indoors, but from the outdoors, I think this link between the social science and policies and things that need to be done, or questions the society asks, puts economics apart from other social science. We had the financial crisis, everyone discussing what the economists say, what they do, why they fail. We have the migration crisis. I don't see any journal talking about sociologists and political scientists failing in their theories. So let me an example of no isolation. I just ran a postdoctoral program, the largest in the social science, the Max Weber program of around 50 postdocs. We were all together in this villa, discussing all kinds of things. One lesson from that is that I should not talk about interdisciplinarity. It's much better to talk about multidisciplinarity. What do I mean by this? That to start with, it's better to understand what each other does. It's better to put aside prejudices. And then maybe we can do something together. But somehow we are not there. And this is not just, this tutto tango, it's not only economists the problem. Hierarchical analytics. Well, there's a paper by Jacques Dress, that you had quoted that one, that they also already made this point. So they look at the top 10, actually top 11 departments in the States, and they look at, they say, well, they have the rule not to hire your own students, but nevertheless, when you look at the faculty, it turns out that 80% of the faculty, actually 79% of the faculty, comes from the top 10. More recently, there's a paper called The Elite in Economics. It's a working paper on the Carlos Tercero. And they provide new data. So basically, they had done a lot of work. And it's about publication records and looking at the top 81 departments and then the top journals and so on, and ranking a lot of people. And the ones who publish in those, they have like 2,700 people, 600 people. And then they put the elites for elite tier three, two, and one, which is a productivity, okay? So the three are just at least half more productive than the rest, and two is half of this half, and blast, so delete one. Yes, that also shows you that it's a very male-oriented, because when you go to the top elite, which still has 123 people that you might name, zero women. And then you can just look at the percentage. But the important thing is, if you look where they work, and now we're talking the gap of the institutions, okay, different elites. So this is just Harvard and MIT, all the other top, the rest of US, Europe, and the rest of the world. So total sample is already shows this bias, okay, but more and more the one that go to the top. If they compare, for example, to mathematics, they also see that in economics that's much sharper. This is where they get their PhDs from. Most economics, that's elite two level from US. And if they look where they hold the jobs, that's clearly different from mathematics. No, it's not talking all the social science here. And this pretty much reproduces the same thing that Dress had found, that the 79% of the top 10 US, look at the different groups, elite, total sample, whatever, got their PhD from top 10 US. So that's some third point I want to make. This is a well-established fact that the hierarchy of publications, and you can call it if you wish, faculty inbreeding at the top. The question is whether this is a profession of insiders and outsiders. And even if you look at something very elitist, like the Nobel Prizes, basically only half of them are in this top. I mean, a little more, but then if you count where they did the job, this is the last 20 years. So there is a possibility of what we call type 2 error, which means accepting mistakes within the insiders. And type 1 error, which is rejecting good things from the outsiders. So anyone who thinks about it and is in an advisory committee or some appointments or some journal or whatever, doesn't just simply automatically look at the numbers in REPEC. It just discounts the top publication from the top places and a great top publication from not top places. If a guy from good guy from Chicago can get a GPE, it just is a bad sign. So how it is to live in this hierarchy with so much consensus? So have it in two parts. Part one, I'll look at the what's the effect on faculty salaries. And this I draw from some work of a former colleague of mine. That's 20 years ago, they asked in the States, in many disciplines, okay, to rank their departments and see how much consensus there was. And then also look at salaries. But let's look at the consensus. So this is a lot of disciplines. This means the lower variance, of course, this is economics is the one that has more consensus, not just within the social science, across different science. On the bottom is like theology or Spanish. They will not agree at all on who is good and who is bad. But then the others will be sort of in the middle. But then those guys, they go on, and what they do is they see what is the effect on the distribution of salaries between being in the first, the 25% quantile or the 75% quantile. And again, at that time, that's 20 years ago, that was making a substantial difference in economics, much more than others, for example, in political science and so on. And this has a clear explanation. It's not only the outside offers, which counts a lot, but also inside, within an organization. If you run an organization and someone comes and says, okay, we have to increase the salary of this guy in economics. Why? He just published another paper and says, so what? The other guy's published 30 papers. What are you talking about? If there is consensus, the dean might go along. If there is no consensus, the dean is not going to go along. So you can, oh, by the way, something I did when I was in there is that we created an academic careers observatory. So that you can click there and find a lot of information about careers around the world, among them, for those things, salaries. So the figures of 20 years ago, they are much more different nowadays. So this is looking type of institutions, full professor, associate, assistant. And this is by tier. That's very similar to the list, but now are institutions. So actually, the numbers are much higher than the ones which I've seen. Okay. And yes, we had this with all the postdocs, and they look and said, oh my God, your economies are really different on that. For the information, for the level, and also for the spread. So for good or bad reason, consensus on academic hierarchy increases income differences based on productivity, and therefore inequality within economics, economies, and within the social science. And that's it. Part two, the effect on the bottom-up funding of the European Research Council. The European Research Council, which is our leading institution for funding in Europe, as you know, is organized in panels. Social Science and Humanities is has six panels, SH1, SH2. SH1 is basically economics, okay? SH2 is basically sociology, okay, political. SH6 will be basically history, okay? There's a little more of between. So what happened here? Well, the first year when it started, there was just an explosion of people demanding, and also economists did very well. What are we seeing here? Well, there are two types of main grants. One is starting grants, and the other is advanced grants. So those are starting grants. So that's when it starts. That's the number, sort of goes down. But what is important is what this really goes down is the percentage, okay, that they get out of the total, right? Now, and what is this? Well, this is the success rate. And this is the success rate, the average success rate in the social science. So they're very close to each other. Similar thing happens with advanced grants, okay? So if the percentage goes down, while the success rates are very similar. What does this mean? Is that there have been less demand from economies, and therefore they get less. You can just do it more carefully. Here is the percentage of applications, and here is the deviation with success rate respect to the average success rate in social science. If it was not that they're giving more to the demands more, you should obviously see like a clearly data like this going down, because when you have a lower percentage, it means you have lower. This should be way, way above. That's not true. We see it a little history, but not in the SH1 at all. In general, we don't see it. And the same thing here for advanced grants. So we see the same patterns or no patterns. So that's another effect. So the populist policy of the ERC of allocating grants based on demand hurts economies. Since by being aware of your position within the hierarchy and having high opportunity costs, people don't waste the time applying if they don't have a good chance of success. So it's not always so good to live in this hierarchy. They make a lot of points about life on their own. And maybe, for example, they say the economy support payment to be made to organ donors, but the public funds the very thought this trivial. What? Elvin Roth got the Nobel Prize and is organizing, changing completely how we do donors of organs. That's an economist engineering at its best. Economists may advise governments, but they do not convince the people. Well, some economists seem to have done quite a good job. So it's being powerful. We have seen that. So let's just me conclude. We economists have incentives in our mantra. We economists have plenty of incentives to be social crooks. But somehow we are not, or just with a small probability. Because we economists love social science, a powerful and delicate science. And somehow also care about the reputation of the profession. And now the math icon is no longer at the zenith of our great hierarchy, and now that we defend and calibrate, we think or wish. Soon the day will come, I have to finish. That we will talk to other peer social scientists. Soon the day will come that we will no longer need to be arrogant to be leading social scientists.
Thank you, Ramon. So the second discussion is Lucrezia Reichlin. Lucrezia is well known to most of you as one of the leading econometricians in Europe. She worked as an economist in France, in Germany, in the UK. She studied in Italy. She's a dedicated European. She's also an entrepreneur. Actually, currently, she's pushing a new project to create a business school in Syracuse, in Sicily, just to mention the breadth of her interests. Lucrezia, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you, Benoit. Thank you to inviting me for this celebrating this anniversary. I was once a beneficiary of one of your grants, so thanks. This is a fun paper to discuss, it goes in the direction of economists becoming more and more introspective. And I don't know if this is a sign of lack of self-confidence or maybe too much self-confidence. So I want to kind of sober up this discussion a little bit and trying to understand what we are really talking about. So the paper does a good job in explaining five things. Economists are paid more than other social scientists. They are more quant, so they use more quantitative models. They are insular. The discipline is much more hierarchical. And then economists are subject to capture, a subject that I think will be, the focus of the next section. So I would like to first see how all these things are related, although in your presentation, I think you did a good job to kind of relating them, and the paper is not clear, these connections don't emerge very clearly. Then I will ask the questions, does economics promise more than it can deliver? And then I will speculate on what will happen to our field in the future. So how are these characteristics related? Let's start from the pay gap. Economists are paid more than social scientists, but are also paid more than mathematicians and physicists. So the control group should have been not only the social scientists, but also the hard sciences. So I think, therefore, that the pay gap is not due to barriers to entry, so the quantitative methods, but it is due to the fact that economics is basically a practical field. So economics focus on policy rather than discovery of fundamentals. As Shiller said after having gotten his Nobel Prize, nobody cares of economic data except as guide for policy. Economics is more like engineering than physics, more practical than spiritual. So because of this focus on practical advice, both for the policy world and for the private sector, economists are in high demand, not only in academia, but also outside academia, and this is why they can command a higher salary. So this is the pay gap is a market outcome. And I think, the explanation to me, it's not that surprising. Now, the second thing is the importance of quantitative methods, okay? What is the role of quantitative methods in self-preserving our tribe? Now, so the question is the key role of practical advice related to the importance of quantitative methods. Could we be engineers without using models? Engineers in the sense of doing policy advice. Now, I think that economics is inevitably linked to quant, and I don't think that the use of words as opposed to models will be dominant in the future. I think that causality and predictions are very fundamental to the definition of our field. But actually, causality more than predictions. Prediction, it's important in many other scientific fields, but in economics, exactly because we give policy advice, causal models are at the center of our discipline, at the center of our methodological, both empirics and so on. Now, you can see that in microeconometrics, quasi-experiments, randomized experiments, structural models. You can see this in macroeconometrics, quantitative general equilibrium models, structural VRs. All this methodological sophistication is basically around the issues of establishing causality and identification. So I don't think one should make fun of that. I mean, but if you want to see if I do that, what's going to happen to that? I mean, we cannot go around that problem. Now, having said that, however, economics is not a science. Sims wrote a famous article in the 1980s saying most of our models which use for policy are based on unbelievable assumptions. So economics fundamentally is not an experimental science. The same data generate multiple interpretations, and therefore it is inevitable that judgment, prejudice, opinions matter. And to that, I mean, it's a clear, you can immediately jump on the fact that, there is a role for capture because, ideology and prejudice and so on matters. So I think economists are rather sophisticated, so this fundamental uncertainty is recognized, and even formal approaches to communicate uncertainty in terms of fan charts, in terms of bounds, ranges, and so on, it's something which is in the field. But a lot of economic practice, especially if policy relevant, totally disregard it. Okay, so the practice of communicating uncertainty is quite rare, okay? So even within the profession, actually, the debates among themselves, if you think, for example, the debate after the crisis, there is a very nice piece by Danny Roderick in Project Syndicate in which he says, in which he criticized Krugman, when Krugman criticized economists, and Krugman says, you have had the wrong model, we should change the model. Economists inevitably cannot have just one model. Economists have models. And, fundamentally, we are not an experimental science, inevitably we have to go for, a bunch of models, and therefore we have to communicate, the outcomes of these models in an intelligent way. But models are needed to make a causal statement, to policy advice. And so, they remain, fundamental to our field. Let me then relate that to capture, making the other connection. Now, capture is inevitably related to the practical policy relevant nature of our discipline. And also to the fact that although the quantitative models dominate, economics is fundamentally non-experimental, okay? So it's both things matter for this. And once you focus on policy, much that is not science inevitably kicks in. And because there are strong rewards to taking positions, simple political position, economic rewards, and rewards of various natures, economists are inevitably vulnerable to capture. And there is also a big incentive to oversell research findings. Policy analysis inevitably is fragile because we have to combine assumptions, possibly unbelievable assumptions, with data, and draw conclusions on these combinations. But assumptions, may be arbitrary or may be unbelievable. And although there is, people have been thinking about this fundamental fragility, for example, Mansky, in a very interesting book, talks about the law decreasing credibility. Credibility of inference decreases with the strength of the assumptions maintained. In practice, policy analysis tend to sacrifice credibility in returns for strong conclusions. Why? Why are we overselling? And I think that is basically because we respond to incentives. So there is pressure and rewards to produce numbers, certitudes, rather than ranges, rather than a more complex type of communication. Some examples, again from Mansky, one economist trying to present uncertainty around a forecast to President Lyndon Johnson presented the forecast as likely range or values, and Johnson answered, ranges are for cattle, give me a number. Also, Hausman discussing with Charles Mansky, you know, when Mansky was presenting the idea of communicated bounds rather than point estimates, what Hausman answered to Mansky, the client needs a number, not an interval. So communicating uncertainty, it is difficult and unsexy. So for sure, we have a tendency to oversell. Now, let me then come to the fourth characteristic, the hierarchical organization and insularity. I mean, here, even the fact that I struggle all my life, or the fact that I didn't get a PhD from one of the top 10, because I got a PhD from NYU, and I think all my career was completely devastated by this fact, I think that the hierarchical organization, it is the consequence of competition. We are a highly competitive field. Why are highly competitive? Because, if we succeed, you can get a lot of money, you can get a lot of attention. And the hierarchical organization, I think, is the inevitable consequence of that, and generates, to go to a top 10 generates large rewards, selection, branding, and so on, and not necessarily bias, although, of course, there is bias. I don't doubt that, but... So I think this is really an industrial organization question. We are all sending our kids to the most competitive school in the world because we want them to succeed. True in other fields. But in economics it's more true than in sociology because we are more competitive than sociology because the rewards are higher than in sociology. I don't know the fact, but it would be interesting to see that economics, in fact, is less hierarchical in terms of recognizing a status linked to age, for example. If you are a young kid with a good idea, you will be very respected in economics. I'm not sure this is true in political science. Also, insularity. Insularity, I actually don't believe that we are insulars, but we have a tradition of colonization rather than cross-citation. Gary Becker, Acemoglu, studying institutions, studying all things that, we have a very, kind of limited understanding of, but, we have been colonizing other fields. And I think that if you just look at cross-citation, you cannot recognize this fact. So we have been open to other fields. And also, with respect to other fields, we have a tradition of importing tools from the hard sciences. Statistics, mathematics, physics. However, economics, for example, even if importing the tools from other fields, has always maintained specificity. And in fact, the attempts of physics to colonize economics in the 70s, chaos model, all these kind of tools have been largely unsuccessful. And the reason why it has been successful is because causality identification is at the core of what we do when we write down a model and when we do policy advice. So the bottom line is that the characteristic of the field highlighted in the paper are connected, and it's very important to understand these connections. The defining characteristic of economics is its practical orientation. This leads to emphasis on quantitative causal model. However, need to cope with the fact that economics is not experimental, and no matter the recent enthusiasm on randomized experiment, fundamentally we remain a non-experimental field. So judgment and ideology necessarily gets in, and which makes the field sensitive to incentives such as monetary or other incentives, and therefore vulnerable to capture. There is also this incentive to oversell. Okay, now part B. Does this mean that economics promise more than it can deliver? Think of macro and micro. I think there is a very kind of stimulating intellectual discussion in these fields about what we can deliver, what we promise, and what we can deliver. I think, in fact, microeconometrics is probably more innocent than macroeconometrics. An excessive faith of the robustness of the results of randomized experiments and the transferability of these results to make more general prescription. I mean, this will lead us to, you know, a complex discussion. But I think that, excessive optimism in that big growing field of empirical research. In macro, interesting, there is a very strong influence of Bayesian thinking. So judgment views are formalized as priors. However, you know, this is not a completely convincing way to deal with fundamental uncertainty, to modeling human behavior away from rationality and so on. But, the intellectual debate exists, although, as I said before, the practice remains mostly oblivious to these issues. So, which leads us to the future. Where are we going? Oops. Okay, so how much flexibility? 1 minute.
Take your time.
I have a couple of slides.
We want to hear you,
So, okay, I want to touch two topics. First of all, the impact of the crisis and monetary policy in particular. Monetary policy not only because it's a focus of my of what I'm interested in, but also because monetary policy is a very interesting case studies because, central banks have used models and advice from academia, in a very kind of, there is a long tradition on that. Now, let me quote Draghi again. This is a speech from last year, and this is what he says. There is little doubt that our simpler understanding of monetary policy in the past will not readily return. Policymakers are operating in a more complex and heterogeneous environment. Structural breaks and model uncertainty imply that regularities of the past can no longer be relied upon. This, in turn, means that judgment plays a greater role in decision making. Okay, as somebody said at the Jackson Hole conference, are barbarian at the central bank's gates, okay? Is it over for us, quant? Possibly, but I just don't believe it, okay? And here I want I think that, there are interesting things that are going on. Again, one of the papers at Jackson Hole this year was a paper by Faust and Lipper, that basically challenge the conventional view in which most of the pre-crisis policy-based advice is centered on. So the idea that central bank best promote inflation stability by behaving in a systematic manner, responding mainly to states of inflation and aggregate real activity. And what they claim in this paper, this is a very chatty paper, that actually there are a whole bunch of things out there in, household debt which do not enter our model because they're too complex to be incorporated in our model. They call this task disparate confounding dynamics. Disparate confounding dynamics basically complicate any conventional interpretation of the business cycle and the appropriate policy response, okay? So what to do, okay? This is quite what to do? So they suggest that basically we will never return to the simple view. So if we have to think at the future, actually they say we can never return to the simple view because that view, that world, even before the crisis, never existed. And, the fact that monetary policy was successful before the crisis, it doesn't depend on the fact that that advice was particularly good. It was maybe just luck. So the new view inevitably will be more eclectic. And I think I see a lot of room in research for combining formal models and judgment. But I don't see us going back to sociology. Thinking about how to communicate uncertainty, how to communicate combination of models and judgment with more formal reasoning. So I think this will be the future, but I don't think that we will go back to something entirely judgmental or entirely descriptive. Now, the second thing, but I think probably I will stop here, but just let me give you The second thing in thinking about the future is the impact of technology in our field, and for example, big data, and the fact that now you're doing taking policy decisions in the private sector and in the public sector has changed quite a bit, because we have access to a lot of data in real time, and so we have to learn how to process them. And the model that economics offer in the market are not totally appropriate for that goal. So I think in the future, probably there will be more emphasis to predictive model rather than causal model, because these are the models that actually allow us to take complex data environment and to reduce it to what is needed for policy. However, if we move towards more predictive models, inevitably we will have to move away from structural causal model to more kind of reduced form model. And again, I don't think this is going to happen. This will make us very vulnerable to, the infiltration from physics and hard sciences. I think economists will strike back. And the reason why they will strike back is because, we are a very competitive field and there is a lot of money involved. So.
So, Jan, do you want to take a few minutes to reflect on the discussants, and then we can collect questions from the floor?
Let me start by saying just one thing, because I started my speech by saying that it was a typical economist presentation where the two sociologists were doing all the job and the economist is presenting. But Etienne is here. Etienne, do you mind coming on the first stage? Because you deserve credit, but you deserve also to answer the questions now. So if you want to first to have a first reaction also on that, me, if I say just one...
Do you mind?
No. So I will let you the floor. Just as a first reaction, so I would like really to thank you for the comment. I think it's really worthwhile and challenging, and we owe you a lot. I agree with most of what you have said, and I think that there are two different points and two different risks in economics now. The first one is this issue of causality. I understand that it is really important, but at the end of the day, there were so many good papers in the 90s and even 2000 that will never be published now because of the lack of causality. And it was really helpful to have them published. I mean, paper by Daron, where he will come with 40 observations on colonialism in Africa, they will never be published now. And having this kind of big picture to advance research is great. And now, this is a risk of becoming too technical, trying to be causal and having papers who talk exactly of the same thing with the 1,000 additional randomized experiment on education, and when you do not learn much more, even if we need numbers. And I totally agree with your point, but some of you, that what really makes the distinctions of economists, we are not necessarily here to criticize economists. Maybe one of the problems of sociologists or political scientists is precisely the lack of willingness to be a transformative, or willingness or natural disposition of being a transformative force, and to really combine those quantitative tools with some practical emphasis. Okay, do you want to react, Etienne?
Sure. I mean, I didn't prepare anything, but I can say a few words. So first of all, thanks for inviting us, and thanks for the discussion, for this great and very honest take on the paper. So I think that the first thing I should say is that this paper was certainly not an intent to berate the economic discipline. Jan is an economist, I myself did econometrics, Marion has close contacts to economists, and it was more an exercise in the sociology and social science of disciplines, and trying to understand how discipline works and how discipline actually get close one to another, how they produce knowledge also. The question was basically how they produce knowledge. And to this, you know, we looked at economists, because you are very important. I believe I'm the only sociologist in this room. We decided, we launched into this long and quite meticulous review and investigation of a discipline in order to understand that. Which means that, you know, we're not trying to be critical here, or not critical in the sense of like berating, critical maybe in the sense, in the more Kantian sense of knowing the conditions of possibility of knowledge. That's more our point. When it comes to the discussion now, there's a few points that could be mentioned. There's actually a lot. The discussion was very stimulating and very honest. It was also very amusing. I really liked your PowerPoint. I got a blast from it. There's a lot that could be addressed because you guys, and especially you, Ramon, disputed basically every claim in the paper. However, I will not engage with that because I don't think we disagree. I think we actually, you pointed out to a lot of data and interesting data which I was not even aware of and which I will use in the future, so I'll take that. So now let me try to build a little bit onto this. Our point in the paper was basically the following. Economists used to be close to the other social sciences and to the other social scientists. It is not the case any longer, or they took some distance. And this departure actually came with a lot of changes. And the question is, what are the consequences? So you both pointed out to like some possibilities in terms of the changes that and of the consequences of this departure. I think we agree, you know, on the basic facts, you know, the departure and the withdrawal. Now the question is, what is the consequence? Once again, there's a lot of things that we could be addressing. There is one thing that I would like to point out. It was underlying in the paper. It was not explicit. We did not really mention it. Maybe there is one point that needs addressing that was maybe the most crucial to Mario and I, and to Jan, of course, was the transformation of economics as an intellectual enterprise. Economics is very much alive. There's no question to this, you know. And today's conference is proof of that. The paper is also proof to this. You know, we would not have written about a dying discipline. But how is this aliveness performed? There's a few things to be said about that. But if we go back onto the different, you know, points that we mentioned, we can see some like broad picture emerging. One, there is more consensus in economics, or there is more, and there is also probably more consensus than there used to be before. Well, that's true. You know, that's true. If you look at every discipline, you will see that economists have more consensus. We do not dispute that, and that is great. That is great. Why is it great? Because it helps you being more cumulative. You know, it helps you actually agreeing on more things. It helps you being more able to discuss. You know, like if you wanted to rank people within just a department of sociology, like you would have people getting nuts at each other and fighting. You know, like there's not even way of agreeing. And so if you want to like make recommendations, build some cumulative science, that's fantastic. However, there's also a risk in that. And what is the risk? Well, the risk is the following. It's what I call monoculture crop. You know, when you like develop, you know, the same sort of consensus, the same sort of ideas, the danger is what? The danger is basically that you are actually somewhat going into the same direction. And we all know, you know, that developing a paradigm is good. We all know also that monoculture sometimes has its pitfalls. The discipline is more applied, you know, and so it gets more traction with respect to politicians. And that is great, you know. There's many times when I wish that sociologists actually would be able to speak, you know, to policymakers. Because, you know, it's one thing to complain that you don't get the hear of the prince or the governance, but it's another thing to be able to speak to them. And so I guess that in a sense, you know, this is one of the great strengths of economists. It is also, or it comes also at a risk, you know, because the more you get applied, you know, the more you get close to like decision makers, the more traction you have. Also, the closer you get to the questions they ask. And so there's the risk here of heteronomy in the knowledge. Basically, what is that? It's the idea that you are given your question by someone else. And so The risk is that then you're going to try to answer the question, how can I improve growth? How can I limit, you know, unemployment? But what do you do of the role of science, which is to invent, you know, the ways to think about the way we think about the world? How about, you know, inventing the future? How about, like, thinking out of a box? And I'm not saying you don't do that, of course you do. But the risk with more consensus is to be taken into that. And so basically, you know, what this paper was trying to show is that what economists have achieved, which is basically an impressive strength and position of power, comes at a risk. The risk of being criticized, the risk of monoculture, the risk of sometimes, you know, being somewhat too close to the questions that people ask you. And that's actually what we wanted to discuss, and that's what Jan presented. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Etienne. So we have time. It's a great opportunity, actually, that we have here a sociologist to answer any question that economists and non-economists in the room would like to ask. So let's go for a few questions. So Luigi, you know, the one great thing of this room is that you have a microphone in your armchair. Yes.
The wow. Superiority this, of a
this
Bank
of amazing
France.
Technology. Now, first of all, thanks for this opportunity. This is a great debate. But I would like to raise two points, one to the paper, the other to the discussion, that seems to be in contradiction, but in fact, it shows how difficult it is to do multidisciplinary research. So, when it comes to the paper, which I like a lot, I think that the paper is written too much like a sociology paper, in the sense that in a sociology paper, it likes to describe and not to ask why. So the description is fantastically done. From an economist, I would expect to say why, in a sense, is it that economists are overrated. So all these things we see is the result of a distortion with respect to some fundamental forces, or is simply the outcome. In a sense, Ramon was going that direction by saying, why do you compare necessarily to the social sciences? I understand the context, but maybe, I'm not saying that's the case, but maybe we look more like engineering, and if you compare to engineering, everything would make sense. So it's simply that we're being mislabeled into social sciences and not the other way around. On the other hand, I think that the discussions, by and large, have been too much like economists, not getting the broader point that the multidisciplinary paper wanted to make. So I don't want to pick with Lucrezia, but I think that she made the best example of this, because she said, oh, we are more competitive. Why am I more competitive? Because there is more money, and so the money will attract more competitive people, and this is perfectly reasonable within the economic framework. Now, the question is, why there is more money in this field, and why we selected to become more competitive. So I make a short story. When I started as an assistant professor, I gave exams that I thought were very good and very rich, starting from a newspaper article and having to analyze, etc. And then I quickly gave up because it was very difficult to sort people out. And I was ordered to simple math exercises that take much less to grade. And when the students come to complain, you can tell them, you're wrong, this is the reason why, go away. And that makes it sorting much, much easier. And to some extent, for whatever reason, we started to use more sort of math in economics, which makes it easier to sort people out. And that attracts more competitive people. So we know, for example, from experimental studies that men tend to be more competitive than women. So the fact that there is an overwhelming presence of men in the profession might be that we have created a competitive environment that is maybe excessive with respect to what we need, and that sort of creates many of the distortions that the sociology explains. So I think that this is a fantastic example of how difficult it is to communicate across fields.
So I have a two ended from Lucrezia and for the...
No, because, I mean, you misrepresented the discussion. I mean, I said the first part All right, but why are we competitive? Because we are a practical field. So in that sense, we are like engineers. So this is why economists are paid roughly like engineers, more than mathematicians and physicists, and more than sociologists and political scientists. So the fact that we are, you know, doing policy advice and that we are fundamentally a practical field rather than a speculative field, I think is at the core of these issues, which combines the incentives and, you know, defines also the, you know, the use of models and so on in our profession.
But I think
now maybe this shouldn't be like that.
No. I'm saying doctors are pretty practical too,
and
right?
they're paid a lot of money.
There's not a question of is how competitive they are. That was my thing. You started
no,
from we are
points.
Paying more, and we are more competitive.
I
say doctors
points.
Are less competitive,
two, no.
and they have more women in the profession.
Okay,
by the way,
no. I made 2 points, and you know, the points were all related. Okay, so competitiveness, incentives, and you know, the nature of our profession.
Can we say just one word? So, there are two things. First, I totally agree. The fact that we are much more quant and we have introduced much more math also explains why it's much easier to get consensus. Now, when we talk in terms of competitiveness, you're right, and I think it was also really part of this paper to say why we are so competitive and why do we have so many outside the chain. Precisely because of this engineering force. Even if you look now at the Department of Justice, or I was thinking Homeland Security, they will hire much more economists than lawyers doing some, you know, coming out from law school. So, and this is precisely because we don't shy away or because we have this habitus of trying to transform that people like us to a certain extent. Now, you're right, maybe the good comparison, I mean, it's really important in terms of social sciences to understand why there has been this departure, but maybe the good comparison now will be also of economists compared to other really physicists, biologists, and things like that. And in this sense, I'm not sure, so maybe we'll try to do something like that, but maybe at the end of the day, we will realize that we don't work neither like hard sciences. Maybe biologists work much more in group and represent themselves in a really distinctive way as we do. Je sais pas, Etienne, si tu veux rajouter.
Two-handed by Ramon as well.
And we have from the floor, maybe.
Ah, so it was. So let me take other questions. So Silvana and then you. So we take at least 2 questions. Silvana.
Well, the rules of the game in economics were written by men, very competitive men. And one of the things that, you know, is striking for a woman is the tenure system. It really, you know, it's a big barrier for women. So we see fewer women, and you know, if you look at the body of economics, it's so homogeneous, male, pale. So there's no diversity in the backgrounds, and probably that limits the background, the diversity in ideas.
Hi everyone, Benani Hamza from the Université de Paris West Nanterre. I think one of the consequences of this economic imperialism, let's say it, is that global issues are treated nowadays with mostly an economic point of view, like for instance the euro debt crisis. Should we stay or get out from the euro? We tend to forget that economic and monetary union was first of all a political project, and also how we treat the refugees crisis with mainly an economic perception, with saying that there is an economic crisis, there is a lot of unemployment in Europe and so on. But let's say that at the end of the 70s, when there was this boat people issue with people coming from Vietnam and Cambodia and so on, I think that there was not this economic, let's say, debate about should we welcome these refugees or no. There were sociologists, demographers, human rights activists and so on, but nowadays, media and politicians do not treat this issue in the same way. Thanks.
I have also a
question. Okay, thanks. Thanks for the paper. I was wondering whether you could push further your explanation of why economists did take power, and not only in academia, but also in institutions, as you said, for example, the Homeland Department is pretty obvious now. Everyone wants to hire some economists. And for me, this is also the product of a more radical change in policy making in the last 30, 40 years. I mean, like most of the sociology historical work has described that. I mean, I don't think that economists were clever enough to take the powers themselves in those cycles. I mean, that something gave them gave the power to them. And if you see the evolution of policy making, I mean, evaluations, rankings are words and concepts that comes everywhere. And these were not invented, I think, by economists. But I think that in the media, it's the same. I mean, when I talk to my friends in historians and sociologists, I mean, they say, OK, it's very difficult for us to talk in the media because it's very difficult to have a kind of balanced view, broad view. It's much easier if you come with just a number of the example of an experiment in this country that the tax rates increased by 10%, and that you can apply that to your country. So I think that for me, this evolution of the superiority of economies that also translates in the media. But when you look at how historians or economists talk in the press 30 years ago, it was extremely different from now. You see also the products of a more radical change in policy making. I think it tells us something on economies, but much more generally on what society and policymakers expect from academia and researchers.
Thank you. So I just want to add one comment and one question. So an anecdotal evidence on us being insular. When Jan was speaking earlier, he mentioned the work of Daron. He was actually talking about Daron Acemoglu, who is professor at MIT. And I'd also like to take this opportunity of having a sociologist with us. When you see this comparison and when you also see the fact that Ramon mentioned that apparently to get European research grants, economics are not doing better than other social sciences. Do you start to see, as an effect of your paper, your analysis, your study of the economic field, that sociology is starting to change itself, bringing more incentives in and to you know, fight back with against economics? And I will give the floor to the four of you, starting with you, Lucrezia, if you want to answer some of the questions which were made.
One answer to you. I mean, of course, I think that all kind of approaches are important. Okay, but you know, for example, data. I mean, I spend all my life doing reduced form models, so. However, I think that the causality, the importance of causality in our model is at the core of the definition of the field, exactly because we are a practical field. If you don't understand this definition, I mean, this role of economics amongst the social sciences, you understand very little about how our field works and the incentives and the pay gap and so on and so forth. Oh, and I think if you look at the, you know, at the history of the evolution of the methodology in economics, I mean, this is, you know, at the core, there is always, you know, because we need to do, you know, to do policy advice, we have to establish identification and causality. So we cannot get away with that. This does not mean that, you know, the studies based on reduced forms or whatever, or historical analysis or sociological analysis and so on are informative. But fundamentally, we survive as a field which has a special position among the social sciences because we are like engineers. At least we claim to be. We claim to be. Of course, this is a territory that economists have to, you know, to maintain. And, you know, there is a certain amount of competition. From outside, and you know, physicists trying to invade the field, also in finance. You know, the attempts in the 70s. Now with big data, there will be something like that. But you know, economists, you know, they have to, you know, they have to maintain this particular role among the social scientists as policy advisors, and only because of that, you know, they can command higher salaries because, you know, a lot of institutions beside academics need economists. So in that sense, I think that is very important to connect all the pieces of evidence that you bring in the paper. And
Ramon, do you want to say a few words?
Yeah, a few things. First of all, something that Lucrezia mentioned. this misunderstanding that economics is not a science, that's a misunderstanding of science, sorry for that. But if one understands how science works, this identification with a particular form of experimental science is a particular form of science. Astronomy cannot do experiments, for example. So there are many things in science, but it's all had to do about the interplay between induction and deduction. Induction based on data and so on, and deduction based on models. And on that, economics had gone farther away than other social science, ahead, I will say. And I think not in this interplay. And then, I don't want to criticize you. I just want to say that something that is misleading in general. Because there's an issue is how you accumulate knowledge and you innovate. And it's true that for accumulation, you had to be a little conservative. Because people had to know, I mean, I cannot just every day can change one place for another. And of course, that has a cost, that then maybe then you're not innovative enough. So that's, again, that's the interplay between these two things, that you see whether science is healthy and evolves. For example, now, we maybe at one point we were too much in the mathicon side, and maybe now we are too much in the thinking that causality in the strict sense of field experiments is the thing to do. That will happen, I mean, we will evolve and we will mature from that. I mean, more worrisome sometimes when you see history that shifts completely to cultural history and it sort of had disappeared from the map. And then now we'll come back again, like hopefully. So we don't have that force. Again, for example, say, okay, these wars worrisome about economics are taking over in institutions and so on. Well, who was there before? Engineers and lawyers. Engineers had been always running all kinds of things. For policy, there are lawyers everywhere. And many policies, one has to make an assessment of what the cost for society is. People don't hire economists for do that. So I think it's just a question of where we are. And for example, we also have this risk. I absolutely agree with you when you say about the things of the risk. But you also have to see the other side. And I've seen it with the postdocs. The risk when you are in a field that there is little consensus is that now, maybe there is not such much competition. I agree with what you said and has been said, and I show it, that we have a gender bias which is way too extreme and is a problem. But then in other fields, depends basically that all will be the personal connections that your professor and so on, and in a way that people start thinking about what? For example, these possible rankings have made that, I don't know, for example, with the assessment, research assessment exercise in UK, now UCL is number one department. And people might criticize the world. Well, that's in a world that before was always Oxford and Cambridge and maybe LSE. So at least when you put the rules clear, that allows for other people to play. In the same way that two Italian women made it to the final the other day, and one of them won.
So, Etienne, a few minutes?
I mean, there's lots of things to say, so I'm just going to have to skip a few questions. I'm sorry, but I do agree with what most of the comments that have been made. I think there's two questions that have been addressed to me specifically, one about sociology from you, and one about why is it that economics became so powerful. I'll start with why economics became so powerful. And I think that here I'm not saying anything which is very new in terms of research because it's been well established, but I'm maybe pointing in directions. One is indeed, there is in the last 30, 40 years, more interest in numbers. And it's not that economists, were actually at the one who pushed that. They actually, they rather surfed the wave. And for that, there is a great book by a historian of statistics called Ted Porter, called Trust in Number, and Ted, in his book, shows exactly that, the rise of the interest in numbers in order to objectively adjudicate situations. And this, is something that, of course, served the economic profession. I'm sure that, this is a central argument. The other reason, you know, which may be a little bit more internal to the discipline, and this is what is shown by another book, another great book by Marion Fourcade, our co-author. Marion has studied the development of a profession in four countries over the last 50, 60 years. And what she shows is basically, well, part of the story we show, you know, like actually being closer to power and asking questions, you know, which are actually more relevant to the decision makers. And as we said, you know, and it happened in four very different ways in the four countries she studies. But this actually is part and parcel of the story where actually, you know, there's a like recursive dynamic where you get, you know, more internal, you know, to the field of power. And once again, you know, I'm not going to like level any criticism against that. I'm just saying this is how it happened. And it's maybe very interesting to actually notice that. Just to dovetail on your comment, you know, like sociology actually describes, that's true. There's a lot of sociology that does not describe, that try to find out general laws, you know. If you look at like the great endeavor of Durkheim in the past century, you know, it was actually to find the main determinants of what drives society and behavior in society. That's pretty, you know, nomological, as we say, you know, like in an attempt to find laws, sometimes way beyond what economists do. So it's not like sociology is only on the side of description. However, I will make a plea in favor of description. You know, it seems to me that even sometimes in sociology, we have gone too far in trying to conceptualize or in trying to find, you know, like causal relations, and that a good description sometimes goes a long way. Finally, is sociology changing? And you know, I think that like the ERC grants is a very good example of that. Well, you know, one thing that is interesting in sociology, amongst a lot of other things, is the fact that it used to be a discipline that was much more national or regional, and so like language used to matter. And as a consequence of all this, the ways of thinking about the world and the and the concepts that were used were quite different, you know, from one place to another. This is actually something that is actually being somewhat made less relevant nowadays, and it's especially true in Europe, you know, with the push towards, you know, Europeanization. So we actually witness nowadays, if not an internationalization, certainly not a globalization, maybe a regionalization. This, you know, you could think is a great thing, and I sometimes think it's a great thing. You know, it's good to go outside and to think, you know, with like what people do outside and to go look at that. It also bears the risk, as I said before, of unification. And unification, when you're studying human behavior in very different contexts, means that you also are going to apply different the same concepts to very different realities out there. If it works, fine, but sometimes, you know, the risk is that you're actually getting rid of the tools that you used to have. And so once again, you know, I'm not having a sort of grandiose argument against internationalization or for internationalization. I'm just trying to be aware of the consequences for the production of knowledge.
Thank you, Etienne. Jan, the last word.
Yeah, so just two words. The first one is that I totally buy some of your arguments about subjection, competitiveness. Now, I think that we tend, as economists, to rationalize ex post things that might not be rationalized. And I'll just give you an example for the male domination. There is now new evidence that, as economists, we behave quite differently compared to all other sciences and even compared to physics and things like that. There is a wonderful paper, Hypnas, okay, in the Proceeding of National Science, where they look at the tenure track and how women get tenure. In all the disciplines, when you control for the number of publications, education, things like that, you don't find a bias at the end of the day. There's only one discipline that remains, is economist. So I think it's a little too short to say that it's just a question of competitiveness, and based on competitiveness, we have no bias at all in economics. We do have, and what this paper tries to say is, well, let's try to understand why. And the second thing is, obviously, people, the audience, the government ask us for numbers, and we are doing a great job for doing this, but we still be aware that as a science, obviously, we need to be really specialized, but big breakthrough always come from interaction between different disciplines. And the fact that we have some kind of colonization of other disciplines without even mentioning the original founding father of the disciplines tell us also something particular about how, as a discipline, we are different compared to the others. Thanks.
Thank you. So I'd like to thank the speakers, and it was a wonderful show, actually. And so we have a 15 minutes coffee break. Let's reconvene at 5 past.
Good morning. So let us resume our conference with the second session. So I am flattered to be your chairman. I owe this honor to an old appointment as secretary of the foundation. So in this old capacity, I'm delighted to give the floor to Professor Luigi Zingales. I think there is no need to introduce Professor Zingales to you. He's not only an internationally acclaimed researcher, although I know that it's maybe a bit of a insular judgment, but he's also a very influential editorialist and writer of great books with a passionate interest in what we think of how markets should function and the difference between good and bad finance. So today he will deliver insights into his presidential address to the American Financial Association. So Luigi, the floor is yours for at most 45 minutes, maybe 40.
Thank you very much for the very kind introduction, and thanks for the foundation for inviting me here and to give an opportunity of such an interesting debate. How do I get to my slides to work? I think that, Henri said correctly, this paper was prepared as a presidential address to the American Finance Association. So when you sort of hear we, et cetera, this is meant to be an exhortation toward the, sort of the finance profession. And this is not, of course, a way to trash finance, quite the contrary, is trying to explain what we need to do better, which I don't think we do enough. So the starting point is in 2010, The Economist organized a debate, and the house statement was financial innovation boosts economic growth. And the surprising fact is 57% of the reader of The Economist, and you don't think the reader of The Economist is a particularly left-wing bunch, voted no. And you think this is a sort of maybe a particular thing, but recently I've conducted a survey of a representative sample of 1,000 Americans, and when asked how much do you think that the U.S. financial system benefits or hurt the U.S. economy, you think that the majority of them thinks that the U.S. financial system hurt the U.S. economy. So the problem is that why should we care? Because one attitude is we shouldn't care. We know better. Some economists say, after all, we don't learn what is right and wrong looking at our students' problem sets. We correct them. So why should we pay attention to what ordinary people think? We know better. The superiority of economists. I think that even if you think you are superior, you have to think twice because, number one, every business suffers greatly from their public image. The public image ends up shaping regulation and government intervention. And this is true in general, but it's particularly true, I think, for the financial business. Why? Because finance is especially exposed to political interference. And is particularly, not only is particularly exposed, but I claim the part that is most exposed is the best part of finance. As I will argue, there is a more competitive and more useful to society finance, and there is a less competitive and less useful to society finance. And ironically, the worse the image of finance, the more the good part of finance would be regulated out of existence, and the bad part will become sort of more prevalent. leading pretty quickly to what I call a vicious circle. So imagine a situation in which there is a challenge to the rule of law, and if there is a challenge to the rule of law, it's very difficult to operate in a financial system in a competitive way, because you can't rely on contracts, and so you need a political support to operate. And if you need a political support to operate, then the only part of the system that can survive is the one that can afford to gather a political support, which is the less competitive section, the more rent-seeking one, which, of course, will lead to a more corrupt version of the financial system that will strengthen the outrage, the people's outrage vis-a-vis finance, which will undermine sort of even more the challenge to the rule of law. And if you think this is sort of just a hypothetical, and not okay, I think it can happen. It happened in the past in the United States. It happens around the world. Dittel and McCulloch have a very interesting paper showing how within the country, those who perceive widespread corruption tend to demand more government intervention. And increase in corruption precede sort of an increase in more sort of populist voting. But it happens even today in America, or at least very recently. One example of this is very few people, especially outside the United States, knows that in 2009, the US Congress voted with an overwhelming majority an ex post 95% tax on bankers' bonuses. Now, the Senate did not vote for that, and so it never became a law. But the fact that the House overwhelmingly voted in favor of that suggests how fragile such an institution is. No matter what you think about banker bonuses, an ex post 95% taxes is expropriation. Even in France, I think that would be considered expropriation. And if you think that in America such a thing cannot happen, they do happen. And why? Because the popular outrage against big banks in 2009 was extreme. Now, ironically, at the same time as the US Congress, that at the time, the Democratic majority was voting this, the US president was organizing a special deal called Public-Private Investment Partnership, where financiers were subsidized to the extent of $2 for every dollar they were putting in to buy toxic assets. And what was the main justification of that? The main justification was that they were afraid of investing in the private sector was afraid of investing in toxic assets because they were afraid of investing, and if you were losing, was their money they lost. If they were winning, they would get taxed subsequently by Congress with something like a 95% tax. And so you don't want to enter a game in which if you gain, if somebody else gain, if you lose, it's your loss. And so they asked the government for some help. Now, the government might have overdone it because the system was designed in which if the loss was mostly entirely borne by the U.S. taxpayers and the gain was mostly entirely enjoyed by the private sector. That was the thing. And in order to qualify for this program, you have to pass through some government review that was basically friend of the administration kind of review. So at the very same time in which the populist outrage was creating some populist reaction, like an ex post 95% tax, the administration was creating some favoritism that will, of course, feed even more the populist outrage once this is exposed. So this is a vicious circle that is extremely dangerous, and I think is important that we try to stop it before it gets out of hand. And when we see, so I hope I explain to you why we should care about this disconnect between what the people think and what we think. And of course, being an economist, I think, what is the cause and who is to blame? And one is to say, as I said earlier, we can blame the public. They don't understand us. After all, we are so superior, as we just shown. But the other is probably there is also some responsibility on our part. And in either way, I think what we should do is to say, it's our responsibility to fix this gap. And what we can fix is, number one, trying to explain better the positive aspect of finance. I think the financial profession does it a bit, but I don't think enough. But second, I think do a bit of introspection and ask ourselves, is this internal conviction that finance is so good based really on solid research, or it's not? And so it's a fact that finance exploded in the United States, around the world, but in the United States particularly, in the last 20 or 25 years. And the question we want to ask is, is it true that is so good? Can we argue from theory, or can we argue from evidence, or can you argue from analogy that that's the case? And so many economists are very sort of keen of saying, if we see a sector that is large in the economy, that's simply the result of demand and supply in a competitive economy. And so it must be that this is good for people. And after all, we have a very powerful tool, which is called the first welfare theorem, that under fairly general assumption derives the conclusion that the result of a competitive economy is Pareto optimal. Now, one of the issue, however, is that the results have been obtained in under the assumption of complete market. Now, Henri Pages is an expert, so I'm very sort of intimidated of talking about this in front of him. But for non-economists, what they assume is that basically there is a market for everything. Which is definitely not true in most real-world situations, is particularly not true in finance. No matter how markets and contingent markets have developed, I think there are a lot of things we cannot, for example, easily insure, and so on and so forth. So under the assumption, if we drop the assumption of complete market, there is a very famous paper, it was Oliver Hart's dissertation, that shows that is not necessarily true, that adding new markets, for example, improve the situation. In fact, adding new markets could lead to a decrease in overall social welfare. Everybody could be made worse off by opening new markets. And a subsequent paper by Ello shows that this is not just a weird counterexample, it's actually a pretty generic situation. Now, with this, I don't want to say that necessarily we prove that adding new market is bad, but we cannot start from the assumption many economists start with that by definition, if there is demand for something, this is welfare improving. Our own economic theory suggests that there are plenty of evidence of situation in which the fact that there is a new market that is endogenously created does not add to social welfare. In fact, it might detract from it. Yes, it's so what for theory? We know the theory can prove everything and the opposite. Why don't we look a bit of the empirical evidence? And there is an enormous amount of empirical evidence, to which I participated in part, that seems to suggest that finance is good. Even the worst critics, like Stiglitz, agree that a good financial system is essential for a well-functioning economy. So there is no doubt that finance does some good. The question, however, is what we observe in the last 20 years or 40 years, all the financial innovation we observe, that did this improve social welfare or not? And the other good question is, we have a very large financial sector in the United States. Is the fact that it's so large a good thing, something that other countries should imitate, or a bad thing? I think that much of the research that we have does not really answer this question properly. Because we have evidence that on average, having more credit over GDP is useful. But that, of course, does not mean that on the margin this is true. In fact, ironically, or maybe not ironically, starting after the financial crisis, a bunch of papers started to emerge showing that if you look on the margin, things might not be as good as they look in the past. And so while up to a certain level of finance over GDP is good, once you pass that level, this might be actually detractive to economic growth and not create economic growth. And it's interesting that, for example, if you look at the flip side, debt to GDP, my colleagues Amir Soufi and Atif Mian show that a high debt to GDP is actually a bad thing, not a good thing. So it seems that we are changing a bit our perspective. And second, if we look at more advanced market, if we look at the sort of banking sector, there is plenty of evidence, but it's mostly on average, not on the margin. If we look at more advanced markets like equity markets and derivatives, I think that the evidence is pretty flimsy, I have to say. The best paper, the one that everybody cites, is this paper by Levine and Zervos, where they show some evidence that market development, equity market developments, is correlated with higher growth. But the measure they find is turnover, how often you trade. And you know, you can build a model in which turnover is the variable, but do you really think that the way to improve Africa is give an e-trade account to every person there so that they can trade faster and more cheaply? I'm not so sure. So when you want to sort of build some policy implication out of this research, is a bit hard to find. And there is almost no evidence for other markets. And when you say there is almost no evidence, I think you should apply a bit of what I call the Sherlock Holmes principle of the dog that didn't bark. Because there are so many incentives to find evidence that the only reason why the evidence is not there is that a lot of people have tried and have obtained statistics that are not significant and as a result have not published. So, collectively, the lack of published evidence can be safely interpreted as lack of evidence. Okay, so there is lack of evidence of that more developed financial markets lead to higher economic growth. Now, can we argue by analogy? In fact, if you look at the United States, there is only one sector that grew more than the financial sector in the economy, and is the U.S. healthcare sector. So from 1960 to 2012, finance grew from 4% to 8% of GDP, and healthcare grew from 5% to 18% of GDP. Now, interestingly, there are a lot of analogies between finance and medicine. I didn't know the quote of Keynes, but that goes exactly in this direction. Think about this. They provide a service that basically everybody needs, but very few people understand. I don't understand anything about medicine, and most doctors don't understand anything about finance. And most normal human people don't understand anything about any of the two. Now, because we don't understand, they heavily depend on trust, both finance and medicine. They are plagued of conflict of interest. In fact, Lucrezia was saying that in experimental science, you don't have capture. Read the papers about doctors, and they are captured by the pharmaceutical industry. Medicine is experimental science, but their capture is worse than economic capture. They both experience a huge amount of abuse and fraud. The amount of fraud in for example, the pharmaceutical sector in the United States is gigantic. And they are both much bigger in the United States than in any other country of the world. Now, recently, some researchers have made this analogy salient. There is a paper called Money Doctor that makes exactly this analogy and say, maybe finance is not great, but it serves a purpose. In this particular case, money manager, they don't really add value in the sense of picking better stocks,
but they add value in comforting people that are stressed, like psychotherapists, and expensive psychotherapists. And at the end of the day, they make sure that more people invest in the stock market, which on average, at least in the United States, had been a good thing. So the alternative, very often as economists, we think the alternative is not to is just to put in an index fund. For most people, the alternative is to put the money in a deposit in a bank, and especially these days, it's not particularly a productive employment. However, I think that the analogy with healthcare system is particularly enlightening because there's no question that the healthcare sector is useful, at least some of it. Like, there's no question that finance is good, some of it. The real question is, do we have too much? Do we spend too much in the United States in healthcare? And do we spend too much in finance in the United States? So, in the US, healthcare expenditure is 18%, is twice as much as the one in the UK and Sweden, probably also twice as much as in France, certainly is not twice as good as the one, at least in France, Sweden, and the United Kingdom. Now, the other thing which is interesting is, in spite of this disproportionate amount of expenditure, life expectancy in the United States is not particularly long. In fact, the United States is only 30 seconds for life expectancy, roughly the same level, actually a little bit below, Portugal and Greece, in spite of spending more than four times per capita than those two countries. Now, of course, this is sort of a stupid observation because we know that in Portugal and Spain, they eat fish and good olive oil and wine. And in the United States, they eat hamburger, butter, and they don't drink enough wine. So maybe all of it, and by the way, instead of wine, they have a gun in every house, which is not exactly a device to increase your life expectancy. So this is not a necessarily a good comparison. However, there is this graph that I found that I find it amazing, which is portray the correlation between the increases over time of medical expenditure per capita and the increases in life expectancy. So we're not comparing Portugal with the United States. We're comparing how much better Portugal does by increasing their life, by increasing their expenditure in healthcare, and how much better the United States are doing that. And the amazing thing is basically all the rich countries are on a particular trajectory, and the United States have a much lower bang for the buck of every dollar they spend in healthcare in the United States. So I think that's an evidence that healthcare in the United States is not particularly efficient. And so my question, since we started with the literature comparing finance with healthcare, maybe the same thing is true for finance. And unfortunately, I don't have any graph as good as this one for finance. However, I think that the question that we should start rising is, as a result of a much larger financial system, are we doing something better in the United States to justify this? So, for example, are pensions much better organized in the United States than, let's say, in Sweden, where the financial sector is so much lower? And the answer is, actually, we don't have much evidence. And the one paper I know, sorry, which is Conquest and Taylor, seems to suggest the other way around, that Sweden allocates pensions in a much better way than the United States at a fraction of the cost. And so the implication is, and because we are an empirical science, once we run out of arguments, maybe we have to start questioning the hypothesis. So if we don't find any compelling evidence that the size of the US financial sector is so much justified by some good reason, then we have to resort to the bad reason. So the possibility, God forbid, that there is some rent seeking in our industry. I think the places where this rent seeking might take place are many. And I will try to present some, and depending on the time, and Henri, tell me when I'm going over my time, I will skip some. But let me just give you a preview. I think that these are not particularly surprising. I think it's important. So my contribution here is not to bring any novel news, but to try to bring it together and say, look, we need to do something as a profession. And so the most important part I see is the later part, in which I say what we can do. So where this rent seeking might take place. But first of all, in duping investors, and I would show there is plenty of evidence of that, in aiding and abetting agency problems, then there is outright fraud, and of course, there is some self-serving government intervention. So let's start with duping. There are two types of duping. There is the most benign one, which is I sell bad stuff to people by hiding in some smoke screen around it. And actually, there is a paper by two French, Carrier and Vallée, that shows how in Europe, retail structure products are sold to normal consumers who don't understand what they're buying. And I've seen this paper present in front of people at Harvard, and David Leibson asked five times, how is this possible? Because he said, oh, if there are some instruments that can be useful in some situation, then you understand why they're marketed. But some of the instruments presented in that paper have no reason to be there. And he says, why a normal consumer, a normal investor, should have an investment that changes with the max of two exchange rates over a period? Most people don't understand what they're doing. So it's hard to imagine that this really serves a purpose. Then there is the more sophisticated duping, that is what Leibson and Gabex indicate as shrouding, where you bundle things in an inefficient way because you have the sophisticated people being cross-subsidized by the unsophisticated one. This is the reason why people who pay their credit card on time get their credit card very cheaply. Why? Because they are cross-subsidized by the people who don't realize that they're going to pay huge fees every time they are late. And what is fascinating to me is competition in this particular case does not fix the problem. In most situations, you say, I increase competition, things get better. In the case of shrouding, as they show, and as the evidence of credit cards show, it's not that the credit card market, at least entering the credit card market, is not competitive, but the situation has not gotten much better over time. Now, what is interesting is this notion that you can dupe people with finance is so widespread that even the government does that. And this is out of an article written by a finance guy who worked for the US Treasury in 2008. And I read it, so I don't misquote him. A key insight is that the underpricing insurance coverage is economically similar to overpaying for assets, but it turns out to be far less transparent. This is the insight that underpins both the TALF and the bank rescue program announced by the Obama administration in March 2009. And so he's saying, we stupid people, when we started, we're actually trying to buy assets directly and overpay directly. This is my interpretation, to be fair. We're trying to overpay directly, and we got sort of destroyed by the public because they figure out we're transferring money to the financial sector. The Obama administration was smarter because they did it in a more sophisticated way, achieved exactly the same result, but people did not get too outraged because underpricing of an insurance is less transparent than pricing, overpricing an asset. So that's the number one consideration. Number two, where there is a lot of rent seeking, is in aiding and abetting agency problems. Again, there is another paper by Vallée that shows this very well. But so think about, most buyers are not buying for themselves, are agents. Agents, like I am an agent of the people if I am a representative, I'm an agent of the shareholders if I work in a private corporation. And we know that in every delegation there is an agency problem. Now, interestingly, derivatives can be designed to be at the same time extremely useful for the agent and extremely bad for the principal. And if you design a derivative like this, clearly is in the interest of the agent to buy it, but is not well for improving. Now, of course, you say principal should take this into consideration and write that into contracts and put limitation. And they do, and they try. However, you know two things. Number one, the speed of innovation might make this exercise more difficult. And second, even if they were to do, there are costs in this process. So it's not a costless process. And we know that this phenomenon will be particularly widespread when you have flexibility of the technology, speed of innovation, and when a principal is not particularly active. And those are exactly the situation where most corporations are, and exactly the situation where finance is. And sorry, I skipped one. Anyway, I forgot a slide, but there is evidence, again, Brian Mallet shows that in France, actually, municipality buys structural products to fool citizens about the level of their deficit. And they do more so the more competitive the environment is for re-election. So that really that shows the evidence that this is a way to dupe voters. And of course, there is outright fraud. I don't want to spend too much time on this because every day in a newspaper, there is a new settlement about a fraud. And I have to say, as a finance guy, and they told me 7 or 8 years ago, is the LIBOR manipulated? I would have looked at them like they were saying, are you crazy? This is the most liquid market in the world. It's the most important. But now we know it was manipulated. And not only, and this is an evidence, but what I want to use is the banality of fraud. It was not only manipulated, but if you read some emails that went on during this manipulation, there was not even the attempt to concede this. It was not even a slight sense of guilt. This is normal business. That's what we do. Manipulating the LIBOR is part of what we do. Like, I don't want to make bad analogies, but you get the sense. And of course, the last thing is government intervention. We know that there is a bailout option implicit in most large corporations. This bailout option facilitates the work in finance, and what I claim can increase the size of the financial sector. And to explain this, let me use an analogy, which I borrow from real estate in the United States. In the United States, I don't know in France, but in the United States, there used to be a very strong monopoly or sort of coordination of real estate that the only way in which you could buy and sell was through the multiple listed service. They were forcing a 6% commission when you were buying or selling. And the result of this, what's interesting is there was monopoly at the level of the real estate, but there was free entry in the real estate market. So the combination of a sort of imperfection in the market, but free entry, leads to what? Leads to an oversize of the sector. Because if you know that there are profits to be made, more people enter, finally sort of bringing to equalizing the rate of return to people. But so in equilibrium, what you will have are too many real estate agents searching for too few deals. So the equilibrium outcome is very inefficient in spite of the fact that no arbitrage condition is violated because the margin on which you adjust is by excessive entry. And I think that's roughly, and there is a beautiful paper showing this, is saying, you know, maybe more expensive houses are more difficult to sell. And so the fact that you get a higher commission in dollar terms for a more expensive house is justified. However, if the value of the land underlying increases, the house is as complex to sell, regardless of the land below is very expensive or not. And this paper shows that where in areas where the land is more expensive, there are more real estate agents per number of people than in the other areas. And this is very much consistent with the idea there is an excessive entry of real estate agents in this sector. And you can argue if the, in the financial sector there is a government subsidy, then there is extra profit to be made. Eventually, these extra profits would be equalized by having too many people in the financial sector, leading to equalization of pay, which is not reached yet, but excessive entry in the sector. Now, the typical response of many economists in this situation is we should intervene and the government should intervene. And in my view, in many cases, particularly the one of the subsidy to large banks, the government is part of the problem, not necessarily part of the solution. So that's the reason why, in front of the finance audience, what I want to say is what we financial economists can do. And then, so this is what I want to finish my presentation, is saying what we financial economists can do in terms of research, in terms of empirical research, in terms of theoretical research, and also in terms of our teaching, because many people forget, but we also teach, and that has an impact in what things go. So in terms of empirical research, I think that we have an obligation to act as whistleblowers of what does not work in finance. And the good news is there are plenty of evidence of cases where the financial profession has does that, from the collusive quotes on NASDAQ to the post-dated stock option to disappearing analyst recommendation and so on and so forth. One sort of problem I have is that this is not enough. Why this is not enough? And my theory is because some data are proprietary, and you can have access only by having permission of somebody, and that somebody makes sure that only certain projects are approved. Not only is that researchers anticipating that if you write a piece of research that is not convenient to the person controlling the data set, will not work, have access to other data set in the future, design research so that eventually you find what is not too inconvenient for who holds the data. So notice I'm not saying that anybody's lying here. That's the reason why it's so subtle and so perversive. Nobody's lying. Everybody responds to incentives properly, but the result is terrible. And so this is true not only in the private sector, also in the public sector. In the United States, the Fed rates banks with a particular rating that goes under the name of CAMEL rating. And these CAMEL ratings are secret. And you can see why they are secret, because you don't want to announce today that a bank is insolvent and generate a bank run. But they are secret not only today, also for the past. In fact, they're not completely secret. Researchers at the Federal Reserve can access them, or researchers who partner with people at the Federal Reserve. However, a colleague of mine actually partnered with a guy at the Fed and exposed the fact that when banks move from a state regulator to the Fed, their rating goes down every time. And this drop is larger when the state regulator is in a state where the bank is big vis-a-vis the regulator. So if this is not evidence of capture, I don't know what it is. As a result, the employee of the Fed miraculously had to migrate to Singapore. And my co-author is persona non grata at the Fed. So this is a pretty stark remarker of the fact you show evidence you don't like, your career is negatively impacted. So I think that that's especially Fondation Banque de France should think about this in the context of Europe, because it's very important. Yes. Now, Also, we don't do enough analysis ex post of innovation. In fact, there has been a lot of debate in the United States about what are called payday loans. Payday loans are a very strange institution in the States because usury is prohibited in the States. But usury is defined as a high interest rate. If you charge high fees, that's allowed. So these payday loans are institutions where you go there, you must have a job and a checking account, and of course no money. And so if you promise to give the check post-dated that will clear the moment you get your new pay stub, they are willing to lend you money under no other condition at the reasonable rate of $50 every $400 that you borrow over a month period. Now, you calculate the interest rate is pretty outrageous. Now, speaking of over sort of blowing on the sector, there are more payday loan stores in the States that McDonald's and Starbucks combine. Now, many of you have never seen them because, of course, you don't need them. You do need Starbucks in the States, but you don't need, hopefully you don't need McDonald's, but you definitely don't need the payday loan, so you don't see them. They are transparent to you. And they are in neighborhoods you generally don't go. But the overpopulation is a pretty indicative thing. And a phenomenal study, the Colorado is experimenting not only with free drugs, but also with a different kind of regulation. And one of the things they did is they did not prohibit the payday loans. They simply put a cap on rates and forced them to market this not as a loans that come due all at the end, but as installment loans that you pay slowly over time, facilitating people to pay back. And this research shows that borrower paid less in interest as a result, but received more credit. And as an economist, say, wait a minute, this business become less profitable, and at the same time, supply increases. This seems like to defy logic. However, little details, there was too much entry. Half of the stores closed. So there were too many stores that in equilibrium, they needed to charge rates very high that caused a lot of defaults and a lot of inefficiency. You reduce the number of stores, you can increase supply to each individual at the lower cost. So this is an example of something that you can do to fix the problem, and this study shows it. Now, unfortunately, this study was not done by any regular academic. It was done by the Puy Foundation, and so I think that we as academics should do more of this kind of study. I don't have a lot of time to discuss the problem with the theoretical research, but all too often, we sort of rationalize the existence, and because my sociology friend would be happy, we are socially embedded. We don't even realize what we justify. We justify what are the most common sort of lobbying position that are around in the system. So that is the reason why I think that good theoretical research should be extremely rigorous and not be too applied, because applied means I deviate from principle in order to fit reality. But when I deviate from principle to fit reality, I'm inevitably forced to borrow from the social debate, and so I lose the only advantage that we have as economists, a rigorous process that forces us to see the world in a different way. I think that theoretical models are very useful to help us see the world in a different way. When they rationalize the existence, are just a poor lobbying tool. And the last thing I want to emphasize is the importance in teaching. Precisely because we like to compare ourselves with physical scientists, we say that we just do positive analysis, we don't do normative analysis, and when we teach, we simply describe the world. However, there is a big difference between an economist and a physicist. The physicist, when he teaches about how the atom behaves, does not affect the behavior of atoms. An economist, when he teaches, especially an economist in business school, when he teaches about how businessmen or businesswomen behave, might end up influencing the way they actually behave. So we need to be careful about this sort of social loop. And there is this evidence that shows that not only people are attracted to economics because they are cheapskates and more interested in money than other characteristics, and yes, Lucrezia said they're more competitive to begin with, but also there is a very interesting study done by Cohen and Elsevier and others that shows that bank employees behave in experiment more dishonestly when you make salient to them their role as bankers. So if you take a banker and you make salient the role as a post officer or other kind of profession, they don't behave differently than everybody else. If you take a non-banker and you make the role of banker as salient, they don't behave more dishonestly. It's only the combination of bankers, when you explain that they should act as bankers, that they actually behave more dishonestly. So we should ask ourselves the question, are we sort of incubating criminals? And are we responsible for that? And I think in part, we might, in the following sense, that when we use as a teaching tools, great contribution of Gary Becker about sort of economic approach to crime. The economic approach to crime is pretty basic by now, everybody understands. You commit a crime when the expected benefits of the crime is bigger than the expected cost. Now, sadly, many of us end up making the mistake of saying that it's irrational to commit, not to commit a crime when the expected benefit is bigger than the expected cost. And what most people call is moral, let's face it, is moral not to commit a crime. Because if you simply don't commit a crime because it doesn't pay, you are just acting as an economic agent. If you don't commit a crime when it's profitable to not commit a crime, you act in the moral way. But we implicitly say it's irrational, which in the economic world is not exactly a compliment. And so you kind of foster an attitude that might not be for the profession overall. So concluding, I think that I believe that a good financial system is essential, not only for the working of the economy, also for freedom, which I value enormously. Now, creating and sustaining such system is not easy, and broad public support is crucial. And unfortunately, in the United States, we have lost much of this support, and it's not easy to regain. And as a profession, we should make the difference. At stake is not only our reputation, but if you're motivated only by economic incentives, our future. If finance becomes a business for political relationship, there is no scope for our teaching services. There's no room for us. And so I think that even if you are narrowly motivated by your self-interest, as a finance academic, you have to care about this. Thank you.
Thank you, Luigi, for this insightful and perspective presentation on the usefulness of finance and more generally what the economic profession could do better. Now to weigh into this introspection, we have two discussions. So in the order they appear in the program, which is the alphabetic order, not the gender order. First, Augustin Landier. So Augustin is professor of finance, a young member of the Institut Universitaire de France and also French Council of Economic Advisors Analysis. Yeah. So the floor is yours. And also one of the foundation's best friends. And thanks.
Okay, thanks. It's a real pleasure to be here to celebrate the anniversary of the foundation. And also, yeah, to pay tribute to the to this partnership between the Toulouse School of Economics and the Banque de France and the Fondation, which has been very fruitful in the past years. So it's going to be always fun to discuss a paper of Luigi. It's also difficult because he's such a colorful presenter. Let me disclose a few biases I might have. So the first is we were colleagues 10 years ago or so in Chicago, which might bias in one direction or another my comments. The second is I am actively involved in the financial industry also. I prefer to disclose that. This might also bias. I will discuss that later. The third thing is I did not predict the crisis. Okay. In fact, I see a journalist from Les Echos, Jean-Marc Vittori, in the room. There is a paper that I wrote that actually said, you know, that the subprime crisis was not likely to be that much of a... so, you know, like this could also create a bias in one direction or another, you know, a bias in saying, you know, it's not my job to predict crisis, or a bias in the direction of saying, actually, we didn't have the data to predict the crisis. So let me start with a picture. So this is Enrico Scrovegni. An Italian banker painted by Giotto. So this guy actually gave a lot of money to Giotto in 1302 to build what is really a wonderful chapel, which is here. And in the chapel, actually, he asked Giotto to paint him, giving this chapel to the church as a sign of repentance for being a banker. And he did not actually stop being a banker. It was just a way to try to buy back a little bit of... And what I find a little bit paradoxical in Luigi's conclusion, in a sense, is this sort of feeling of not fake humility, but that, you know, like, let's try to do something to buy back our respectability, in a sense. So why was Enrico so worried about his respectability as a banker? In fact, his father... was shown in Dante's Inferno. His father was part of Dante's Inferno. Dante met him in the seventh circle of Inferno with all the bankers. And bankers at the time were seen as violent men. The seventh circle is the circle of violent men. And why? What kind of violence? It's called violence against art. Namely, so it's not art in the sense of, it's in art in the sense of making things. The violence of bankers is the ability to make money without making anything, in a sense. And that's the scene, in a sense. And it's perceived as stealing time. And so you have to pay back for this time you stole because you made money out of nothing. And, you know, so, I mean, with this view, so we have to decide a little bit whether, you know, we feel there is some misunderstanding or whether we should also, you know, say there is some truth with this view. In Europe, something disturbing with this view is that it is very related to anti-Semitism. And you see a lot of these pictures coming back in the 30s, which is the last backlash, really strong backlash against finance, with a lot of pictures against bankers and stuff like that. Even in Tintin, you still have, so it's one of the most controversial pictures in Tintin. I mean, there are a few of them also in Tintin in Africa. But this one, the name of the banker, which is now Bolwinkel, was changed in 45. It was Blumenstein before, and it really like pictures this this view that the banker is making money out of nothing. So here the guy says, "Hey, you must know." So he's speaking to one of his collaborators, and he says, "You know, if I decided to finance this this enterprise, you know that it must be that I know that it can only succeed because I will make sure that the competitors fail, basically. And he's sabotaging the boat of Tintin, etc." So in a sense, that's the view of, you know, like, is finance really producing something? Is it doing real stuff? Or is it just sort of a parasite industry which is trying to, you know, like, get a slice of profits without really producing stuff? And the modern version of that is the Wolf of Wall Street, with this view that, you know, finance is just basically an unproductive activity which exploits the biases of people. Okay, so I think there are two parts of Luigi's talk. You know, one is, as researchers, how should we think about the industry and whether, you know, like, some parts of it are really counterproductive in the sense of being socially inefficient, harmful. And the other is, as a profession, what should we do? What's our strategy to, you know, like, try to find a respectable role to play in society? Okay. So what are the possible strategies? One is ignore it, you know, and that's a possibility to say, look, I mean, this looks really like caricatures of the 30s. We don't want to mingle with that. It's populism. We could fight it. We could say, look, there are a lot of fallacies, misunderstandings behind that. You know, like, for example, this sort of fallacy of services is not real stuff. You know, like SpaceX is real stuff. These guys go to the moon, but the financial industry is not doing real things and it's still making lots of profits. Looks suspicious. And the third way, which is the way, you know, Luigi sees as more reasonable, is, you know, to do a little bit of self-critic, of mea culpa, or maybe to tone down some of her views that finance is good and try to disentangle good finance from bad finance. And then, you know, asking ourselves, are there things we should change in the way we teach and research finance? Okay, so let me give, you know, a few of the key ideas of Luigi's talk, which I think should be remembered, and then my own take on some of these ideas. So a first idea is, or a diagnosis, is this view that, you know, maybe the industry, the finance industry in the US is really like, the size of that industry is really too big for the claim that it is an efficient size to be reasonable. The plausibility of this idea that the size of finance is efficient has become less, it's less plausible after the crisis. In fact, Luigi says, you know, we have only limited evidence that finance impacts growth positively. And actually, I mean, some of the most famous contributions are by Luigi. So if Luigi says that, there must be some truth to it. And he says, you know, actually, we also have evidence that excess credit can harm growth. And more evidence that rent-seeking technological change might actually be behind what we call innovation in finance. To pay tribute a little bit to, you know, like this idea of rent-seeking technological change, it was formulated by Hobsbawm in 69, saying, you know, it is often assumed that an economy of private enterprise has an automatic bias towards innovation, but it's not so. It has a bias only towards profit. And then it was, you know, there are two papers, contemporary papers, one by Bommel, the other by Murphy, Vishni, Schleifer, making exactly that point that, in fact, entrepreneurs are not looking for ways to innovate. They are looking for ways to make profits. And so if the system is such that you can make profits by being a parasite, then you will. Many people will do that. Bommel says, you know, the entrepreneur may live a parasitical existence that is actually damaging to the economy. At the time, actually, lawyers were seen more as the paradigm, as the generic example of that, more than bankers. But they also quote bankers, mostly investment bankers at the time. And Murphy, Vishni, Schleifer also have a paper on that theme saying talent goes into activities with the highest private returns, which need not be the highest social returns. So the second idea of Luigi is, you know, we should start taking seriously the hostility of the public as a signal that there is might be something wrong with finance. So we should probably spend more energy denouncing bad stuff, maybe do more policy work, and I quote Luigi, use teaching to curb rent-seeking dimension of finance. The third idea of Luigi is that regulation is not enough in the sense that, you know, there is regulatory capture, so we cannot just answer by saying, look, it's not our job, it's the job of regulators. We can help saying, you know, what to do, but Luigi has a view that it goes behind this issue of regulatory capture, and he has this idea that there is a life cycle of agencies. You know, when a problem is big, basically people know why we regulate, and then slowly things, you know, lose their purpose and don't work anymore. So a few comments, you know, my role as a discussant, I think, is to try to find some counter-arguments. So in a sense, some of what Luigi says might be a little bit too severe in the following sense. I think behavioral finance, and actually finance as a discipline, was quite welcoming to behavioral ideas, and behavioral finance has included a lot of ideas, and especially like predatory lending was part of the corpus of, you know, what was taught in a typical behavioral finance class before the crisis. So it's not something that, you know, was totally out of the mind of people. Second thing is forensic finance is also something that precedes the crisis with a lot of papers. It's actually very easy to publish a paper if you have good forensic evidence. Actually, my own experience, like my most easy publication in the Journal of Finance was a forensic paper on do hedge funds manipulate stock prices. Like the demand for this kind of paper is actually very high. And so if you really can bring evidence to the table, the field is very welcoming for this kind of evidence. The third thing is, and that's really an effect of the crisis, participation to the public debate of good academics is up. That's also a good thing. If anything, in a sense, I think one of the sins of economists before the crisis was, and that's especially true maybe in Europe, that a lot of the debates was left by professional academics to other types of economists. There was a sort of divide of the profession between people participating in the debate versus people trying to be pure academics. The third point is, you know, this backward-looking bias of economics, I think, is normal and is going to stay. Like, I think our job is not to forecast. So in a sense, I am saying what I was predicting. We are not forecasters. And in fact, if anything, I think we should do more history, you know, rather than less, and not pretend to have answers to things for which we don't have the data. It's true, we didn't have the data for many things. We still don't have the data. I mean, one example, for example, is quantitative easing. Like, we can predict that in 15 years from now, there will be a bunch of papers on side effects of quantitative easing and how difficult it is to get out of it. Okay, but it would be difficult today to bring a publishable paper to the table based on something for which, you know, like we cannot really bring even like relevant history elements. Okay.
Augustin, you are ruining my reputation as a chairman.
Could you wrap up, please? No, but what's my so how much time do you have? Zero. Okay, but let me accelerate then. So maybe, okay, one bias in research, I think, in what's called good research is this sort of, you know, strange mix of plausible and surprising. In theory, I think the danger of this is the need for counterintuitive results. And if you look at actually the crisis papers written by theorists, you will see a lot of papers on the pro-opacity side, for which there is a demand, okay, in this regulatory debate, but making a case for transparency is, in most cases, very trivial. It's more subtle, theoretically, to make a case for opacity. And actually, most theory papers are on that side, almost as a reflex, because, you know, they are trying to produce something counterintuitive that is not a simple consequence of assumptions. Empirically, so we have already talked about that, like there is a lot of focus on causality, good causality, but I think it's not going to go away with the crisis. Like, we need only well-established causality is going to be published. Welfare analysis, I will just say, you know, one word on that. I think one big problem, so is doing welfare with behavioral agents. It's common to many fields in economics, but in particular to finance, because we are so mingled with, you know, the gambling industry. If I ask you, you know, what's the US consumer spending in casinos per year? The answer is almost $40 billion a year. And in fact, you know, part of finance is the same kind of output as that industry. And, you know, in terms of regulation and welfare implications, what do we say about that? You know, like, gambling is regulated, both, you know, casinos and finance, meaning that not everyone can do anything. But what do we say? You know, it's clearly not clear for us why we should let people gamble, but if there is a big demand for gambling, also, they might reflect preferences. In teaching, so here maybe, you know, like, just, and I will conclude, don't worry, Henri, so let me conclude here. I'm a bit skeptical about this notion of, you know, we should teach morals to students. I mean, I agree with what Luigi said, but I think what I see as the original sin of the finance profession when it comes to teaching in business schools is that we find normal to teach stuff that does not work at all. So we keep teaching the CAPM, we keep, you know, teaching discounting with the CAPM, even if we know that it doesn't work at all. And there is a more and more big disconnect between research and these sort of bread and butter questions about, you know, how do you discount cash flows, this kind of stuff. So I think, you know, maybe rehabilitating a little bit the sort of bread and butter questions, both in asset pricing and corporate finance, the same could be said about corporate finance, will matter. But the CAPM, again, does not work. It's part of the classic teaching of MBAs. I will, okay, let me stop here, maybe with one word on pluralism in finance. I think, you know, what is a little bit worrisome is the lack of pluralism in finance. It's in that, I mean, in that direction, I already joined the previous talk by that was done in the previous session. I think the discipline is not very welcoming for sort of orthogonal approaches like econophysics. I think there are clear biases in the editorial process. Actually, just to finish, one word on a paper I'm writing with Bruno Biais on this kind of biases. So it's not like to protest, because Bruno Biais is actually an editor at the Journal of Finance, but he was kind of struck by the change in behavior before and after he became an editor. And so we are doing a paper showing that it's a very general phenomenon that editors first get quoted massively more during their editorship, then it fades away when they stop being an editor. But it's also the case of all their colleagues. Okay, this is what happens to the colleagues of an editor in the top three finance journals when one of their colleagues becomes an editor and stops being an editor. And you see that it's an effect that is much more acute for that's the journal when the guy becomes an editor. And there is a little bit of an echo in the other top three journals, but less so. And anyway, so that's something also we should think about. And that's also what the Fondation Banque de France is doing by trying also to think about, you know, how, in a sense, Europe can be back to the game in economics and finance. And that's it. So thanks a lot. It's obviously a very fun paper. It's thoughtful and provocative. Just as a final note, you know, another role that central banks can play is obviously to try to liberate the data. Ultimately, you know, like as Luigi was saying, when the data are there, people look at them. If they don't find anything, probably the dog that didn't bark interpretation is fine. But for many situations, we don't know if people really had the opportunity to look at things, so we cannot apply that principle. But thanks a lot, very fun paper, and it's also an original idea to put together this session. Thanks.
Thank you, Augustin, for this lively and long discussion. So we are running out of time. Sylvana, I do not have time to account for your reputation. I just remember that you are one of the foundation's research fellow. And so the floor is yours.
And the recipient of one of your grants, so for which I'm very thankful. So it's great to be here to join this celebration and to discuss this very timely paper. Let me start from the beginning. So, does finance benefit society? Obviously, this is a very important question, particularly in the current economic climate. We learned from a survey carried out by the University of Chicago that nearly half the respondents think that finance actually hurts the US economy. And I learned from this paper that if you are the typical financial economist, you should actually be shocked by these answers, because there is a vast body of evidence pointing to very positive effects of finance on different economic variables. So it's very tempting to dismiss this survey evidence, but what Luigi is doing here is saying to his fellow financial economists, take them seriously, and we need to take action. So as an outsider to the world of finance, I actually didn't find the surveys very shocking. I thought it was a natural response to, in a country which is coming out of a very deep crisis triggered arguably by financial factors. Moreover, the media has made very prominent that several financial players drawn from the very top 1% of the income distribution have displayed blatantly unlawful and unethical behavior. And this is all aggravated by the context. In a period in which finance experienced its meteoric growth, the media realignments in America have not moved at all. They are exactly the same as they were back in 1979. And moreover, inequality as a whole has soared. The richest 1% of Americans now own more wealth than the bottom 90%. And this inequality is even more marked if you look just at financial wealth. And I like to dwell on this point because I think that a lot of the dissatisfaction with finance by the American public is linked, whether justified or not, is linked to the increasing inequality. And I would like here to open a critical parenthesis to one of the quotes that Luigi does. I mean, in building his argument, he points out that finance actually reduces inequality, invoking a paper by Beck and co-authors back in 2007. But hey, if you look at this paper, it's really based on cross-country regressions, 60-plus observations, poorly identified, with all the textbook econometric problems you can think of. So we shouldn't be even citing this kind of evidence, because it's not evidence we can believe. I mean, the method is flawed. So in a way, Luigi falls into the same sort of practice that he is criticizing. So let me close parenthesis here and go back to the question. So It's a difficult question because finance is a very broad term. Are we talking about the financial industry itself with its particular IO structure, concentration of power, people, the regulatory framework, which can be changed? Or are we talking about the essentiality of the financial services, and if so, which ones? Obviously, there's a huge range of financial services and products. And to make the analogy with the food service, with the food industry, there are some healthy food categories and some that are junk. And even within very narrowly defined categories, take cereals, which is the darling of IO economies, there's a huge variation in characteristics and in suitability to different people. So I very much agree with Luigi's call to start differentiating different products and trying to understand which ones are beneficial and which aren't. But beneficial for whom? What exactly would be the metric here? We can well establish that finance actually causes growth. But if that growth is accruing to the top 1% of the income distribution, well, that's not really beneficial to society. That's beneficial to a bunch of outliers out there, those 1%. So I think it would be very useful to have a more discussion of what's the metric here, how do we say that something is beneficial for society? And Luigi worries a lot about this anti-finance sentiment because he has a very specific mechanism in his mind. This will increase the demand for intervention and create a vicious circles whereby financial returns in the financial sector fall. This leads to big financial players to lobby regulators. This, in turn, leads to lower returns in the industry, and so on and so forth. So my reaction was, well, maybe, but there are other positives from this reaction to finance. I mean, it's in a way a very healthy response to a system that was already very vicious, and it can bring a lot of other positive byproducts. So in a way, I mean, I will stand talk about the allocation of talent. So these lower returns in finance might lead to reallocation of talent in the economy to more socially beneficial activities in the spirit of Murphy, Schleifer, and Vishnu, to cite some financial economies. It will trigger more scrutiny by law enforcers and financial economies, and this is part of Luigi's call today. And maybe the conclusion we find is that finance actually has grown too far, too large, and some services are just opaque junk. And so I think I view this anti-finance sentiment as a positive, not as a negative. So Luigi goes on to give us a list of things that financial economists should be doing in light of this background. So, and they're all very common sense. He's asking for more balanced empirical work, which exposes the distortions and uncovers all the wrongdoing in the industry. And here it's actually quite shocking that most of the papers revealing wrongdoing in the industry came out after the crisis. So I think it's a very valid call right now. More rigorous theoretical analysis, more focus on policy rather than the politics, and I'll come back to this, and improvement in teaching of financial economy. So I agree with most of these points. Just a couple of footnotes here. I think the conflict of interest here is the most problematic when we talk about empirical research, because financial economists are working in and out of the financial sector, and this is good because it allows them to understand better the plumbing of the financial industry and probably gain access to data. But as soon as they start uncovering this wrongdoing, they and their future colleagues will lose their gigs. So in a way, we need to find a way to incentivize people to, you know, uncover this and be ready to lose their gigs. And I don't know, you know, there might be a way to work out those incentives there. rigorous theoretical analysis. I mean, I'm sure that financial economists who in theory always believe they were rigorous in the sense that the conclusions follow very logically from the assumptions and so on and so forth. Even those who were working, particularly those that were assuming rationality, perfect competition, and so on and so forth, there was rigor in there. The problem was precisely with the assumptions that necessarily embed an ideology. Just to give a very quick example, the less rationality you assume in your agents, the more your policy recommendation will go towards more intervention. So I think in that sense, I mean, it's not rigor. I would say more clarity with the assumptions and what ideology we're embedding in those assumptions. Luigi also calls for more focus on policy and ignoring the political feasibility. But I like the principle, but all our models are necessarily partial equilibrium. We're not modeling everything. We're not modeling the Big Bang. So we need to take constraints from other problems that impose restrictions on how much we can do or not. And if we work out the optimal policy, then we end up with, like in macro, with many policies that are sustained with lump sum taxes, for example, which we know we cannot implement, and we wouldn't be able to implement in a broader model in which we take into account the heterogeneity in the population and so on and so forth, and this sort of inequality concern. So fine to work out the optimal policy, but you do need to take into account why those other constraints exist in there, because we're not modeling the whole of reality, we're just taking a very partial view of it. And I couldn't agree more about the teaching of financial economics, which you would know more than me. So if I could add a couple of points here, I think eventually the field will have to go more quantitative in order to weigh in the results from this empirical work. They'll need to calibrate the optimal policies, and as this new research comes, reveals the pros and cons of different financial products, there will be a bigger need for bigger quantitative models. And last but not least, I think we should do, or financial economists should be doing more work on forecasting, particularly of systemic crisis, and this should be something that should be much more rewarded in the profession. And I Lucrezia, who's not here, I actually think we should let in more engineers here. If they're better at doing the forecasting, they should be very, very welcome, even if they take a share of our salaries. So just to take stock, this is an article full of common sense. In fact, so much so that as an outsider, I did wonder why Luigi had to say so many obvious things. And here I have to say I did worry that at the time he's saying these obvious things, he's also urging his fellow financial economists to participate more in the public debate. Because if these people have to be told all those things, well, I'm uneasy about getting them in a public debate and getting them involved in the policy-making process, which might lead to very weird policies. So, as I said, he's saying many obvious things, and perhaps they need to be said. I don't hang out with financial economists that often, let alone those from Chicago. And to conclude with a more positive note, to paraphrase George Orwell, sometimes the restatement of the obvious is the first duty of intelligent men. Thank you.
Thank you, Silvana. I think the time frame of the conference doesn't do justice to the interest of the topic. I think if we want to deal with specifics, there will be a lot of interpretation problems. For example, I remember Ramond you alluded to TARF program. Ramon made last Friday a presentation. You have clearly different views on the usefulness of TARF. So in the interest of time, I will just ask one or two questions from the floor, and I will maybe Luigi can respond globally. Ramon, do you think that TALF was really overpaying assets, or there was some...
I think that I enjoyed a lot the presentation and the discussion. A colleague of his says that we don't ask these questions, whether the sector is too big or too small, because sometimes it reminds that when people thought that industry should not be there because we're not doing the real thing, which was food. Okay. So, and those are tricky issues. But I think that what is very important is to understand exactly, as much as we can, where these moral aspects come in that you are raising. I think that's something that we should be more aware of in profession. This happens constantly. In particular, because, as what I said before, now the media is more into it. And any newspaper has economics and finance pages and everything, and it's very easy that they will quote or misquote economists or financial economists in their own interest or whatever they think it just makes the date. And so the fact that there is so little culture, one thing we should insist, not only how we teach, is why undergraduates, not undergraduates, in high school they don't know a little more about these things. Someone before was saying that we are forced to give points, numbers. But the same thing happened with the medical profession. It was very difficult that the doctor would tell you, well, with some probability, you're going to die afterwards. No, we don't hear that. But that's exactly what people should train, that's exactly the kind of thing we are, is risk. Even the way that we're trying to design now the banking union, it seems like we're trying to design it in a way that there will be no risk. And that's exactly what he said. Don't worry. The citizen will never have to pay for that. Always the banking will take care of all the risk. That's like the bad start.
So first of all, I want to thank both the discussants for an excellent job. And in particular, I don't know whether he knows, I would like to thank Augustin because Scoveni is from my hometown, Padua, and where there is the beautiful chapel with his name by Giotto. If you've not visited, you should visit it. Maybe it's because of that I have this background. But no, most seriously. In the book with Ragu, almost 15 years ago, we actually tried to explain why the middle-aged view of finance was wrong and why this notion of we don't produce anything useful is completely wrong. And by the way, now a lot of professions don't produce anything real, but they're still very useful. So I think that my concern is that now the objections are maybe with a background of the same origin, but they're much more founded than they used to, and I think we need to confront them and see to what extent they are correct, to what extent they're wrong. Another interesting anecdote that it used to be the case that the gambling was taking place at the New York Stock Curb Exchange, that is the progenitor of Amex, and at some point they decided, I think in the 30s, they decided to distantiate themselves from gambling precisely because finance did not want to be regulated and treated like gambling. I think that most financial academics will not agree with your view that the two are the same. But it's an interesting way to look at them. To Silvana, I agree with you completely that there are some good things coming out of the anti-finance sentiment. In fact, in my book, A Capitalist for the People, I claim that some dose of populism, I know this is a four-letter word in Europe, but in North America, there is a history, actually, good populism, And some populism actually can be useful to clean up certain environments and in finance in particular. And you're absolutely right that I say a bunch of obvious things. And I think what is not obvious is to say them in that particular environment. In fact, a lot of people ask me later if I write a book about that. I said no, because the people at large know precisely what I'm saying. So I don't need to explain it to people at large. I need to explain in that environment because we suffer a bit of groupthink and we don't listen enough to that. One last point, which is very dear to me, is the issue of the political feasibility. I think you're absolutely right that if you think that lump sum taxes are not feasible, you shouldn't necessarily make all your prediction in that. But I think what you should do is probably change your models because there is something missing in your model that is important that leads to something that doesn't make any sense. What I am more concerned is the reaction that I got in many circles that you should not propose certain things because they are not politically feasible in the sense that, for example, they are against the interest of the banking industry, which is very powerful lobbying. So if I internalize those constraints into my models, then de facto, I'm basically reproposing the lobbying position of the banking industry with a bit of math. And not, I don't think that that should be the goal of some academic researchers. But thank you very much to everybody.
I would like to thank wholeheartedly both the presenter and the two discussants on behalf of our governors and all the attendants. They made a very nice job. I'm sorry, we have the awards to be celebrated now. So thank you very much again.
So, ladies and gentlemen, it's now time for the awards. You know that the prizes of the foundation distinguish young academic researchers for their remarkable contributions to economics. They are developing new ideas that hopefully will improve our understanding of the behavior of economic and finance and their consequences. So, in a nutshell, their research is of great economic interest for policymakers and central bankers. So maybe you're aware that each year we award two prizes to young researchers. But we're taking advantage of our 20th birthday. And today we will award four prizes, two for 2014 and two for 2015. Let me just highlight that we target candidates who are affiliated to a French university or institution. When applicable, we also fund a partial release from teaching obligations. With these prizes, so we do not distinguish only the quality of the outstanding works, but we also provide, I hope, a showcase for the French institutions that support them and help them to achieve top-level contributions. The laureates have been selected by a jury of international experts, so I would like to thank very much the jury for their commitment in the difficult task of screening the process. So, dear laureates, it's a privilege to convey to you on behalf of Banque de France Foundation our warmest congratulations. Now, allow me to introduce each one of you. Maybe I have to say that I'm going to give the 2014 laureates a diploma, but they've already received their checks, so I won't give their checks today. So the first prize I mentioned is awarded to Mr. Yinghua He. So welcome. Please come to the to the podium.
Merci. So, you have a PhD from Columbia University, and you're now an assistant professor at the Toulouse School of Economics. So your contributions cover many areas of applied microeconomics, including labor economics, education, industrial organization, and they are characterized by carefully designed empirical studies. You also dealt with the financial fields. You reviewed the impact of increased transparency on market liquidity in the stock exchange. And another one of your work, with first-class academic potential, assesses the influence of institutions and regulations on whether strategic behaviors are observed in ordinary life situations, such as the choice of schools. So all my congratulations for your diploma. I have to hand it over to you. Here you are. It's a modest piece of paper, but I
Thank
hope
you.
It's...
Thank you.
Thank you. So now I have the pleasure to call on Johan Homber. Hello. So you've obtained a PhD degree from the Toulouse School of Economics, and now you're an assistant professor in finance at HEC, HEC. So you heard you have a lot of work to do. Your publications include both theoretical and empirical works. You have made important contributions in numerous areas of financial economics. Your research interests range from market microstructure to corporate finance. And you wrote papers on the behavior of high-frequency traders and their consequences for market liquidity and volatility. But you also wrote on the effects of lending relationships on the funding of innovative firms, as well as on the impact of reforms that favor small business creation by unemployed workers. So congratulations too.
Merci.
Here you are.
Merci.
So now I turn to the prize for 2015. And the first person I would call is Monsieur Paul Hubert, who is right there. Bonjour. So you prepared and defended a PhD thesis at the Institut d'études politiques de Paris, and you are currently a researcher at the OFC. So you have clarified how central bank communication interacts with the private expectation formation process. Needless to say, this is of utmost interest to us and utmost importance. Agents' forward-looking decisions indeed are supposed to depend on expected real interest rates over long horizons. And to form long-run expectations regarding real interest rates, they must take a view both on future developments in the economy, but very much also on the reaction of the central bank to these developments. So the effects of monetary policy are dependent on how those expectations are formed and how central banks affect them. You've already written 14 articles, including top-tier ones on these issues, not to mention contributions to book chapters and policy papers. And earlier this year, you received another award, if I may, or a grant rather, from the foundation for a very promising joint project with Stefan Hansen and Michael McMahon on central bank communication and inflation expectations. So all my warmest congratulations for your prize and your future work.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I got two things. Okay, and our last laureate is Christophe Spaniers. I hope I pronounced correctly your name. Difficult for a friend. So you obtained a PhD at Tilburg University, and you also work now at HEC Paris as an assistant professor. Your research agenda covers an original segment. It's in the field of household finance, and it has to do with the behavior underlying the market for luxury assets. And luxury assets, if I'm correct, include collectible stamps, wine, rightly so, art, but also the upper end of real estate in Paris. Those are obviously non-standard investment vehicles, and by studying them, you provide new insights on the issue of liquidity, volatility, and diversification, which are of importance on the traditional financial markets, but also on these markets. And you've also constructed novel databases on these assets, on their transaction prices that you release on your website. And this initiative is topical in reminding us of the importance of assessing quickly and easily new data for developing top quality research. So all our congratulations. And here's your diploma and your check.
Thank you. Yeah, I'll hide the check.
So, maybe a last word to conclude on those prizes. We deem them as stepping stones to more ambitious research programs, and we are very eager to see all of our laureates providing us with even more conceptual, empirical tools, and ultimately answers to our questions. And you've seen there are many this morning. Thank you all.
Thank you.
No, I won't be long, but I would like to say a last word. Well, thank you very much, Anne, for the prize awarding. It was very nice, and I'm very happy to have seen that. I think it's a good opportunity to come back to the foundation and its role, and maybe have a quick thought about the historical overview of this foundation for monetary banking and financial economic research. I believe a lot has been achieved since 1995. What was our goal? It was to promote excellence in academic research in the field of monetary policy and finance. What did we achieve so far? Well, in numerical terms, a lot, certainly. 300 conferences and seminars have been sponsored. The research grant program has also awarded 81 grants for about 2.4 million euros in total. It is, of course, difficult to identify the potential outcome of projects at an early stage, but indeed the program has been rewarded by excellent outcomes. Most papers were published in the best international research journals, and not just academic successes were achieved. Some papers were also financed by the foundation later became hot policy topics, sometimes with very good insight. For instance, I think of a paper by Freixas, Parigi, and Rocher on systemic risk, interbank relationships, and liquidity provision by the central bank that was published in 2000 in Journal of Money, Credit and Banking. In 2000, that is 8 years before the crisis, and yet the paper already underlined the importance of interbank relationships and the spread of risks. Some trends and evolutions in research in economics and in the work of central banks over the last 20 years were also identified and discussed. Obviously, globalization, international leaks have played an even more important role in monetary and financial economics, including the creation of the euro, for instance. There were also changes in economic research as more attention was progressively given to actual policy making. One of course, the leading examples is the so-called Taylor rule, which was created to describe the actual behavior of central bankers, or especially the Fed at the time. But this allowed a much richer interaction between academia and policymakers, and indeed we all still have a look at that from time to time, even if very much of the result depends on the assumption you put in the model. Changes also affected policymaking, with more attention paid to academic debates. This even influenced the very structure of central banks. Research units were put into place and developed in most major central banks, including the Banque de France, which also, by the way, implemented an external evaluation of research. Thank you very much, Lucrezia, if you're still there. Central bankers indeed realized the importance of conducting their own research activities to support policymaking. Heavier use of theoretical findings and data-based analysis was made in order for central banks to better articulate the policy actions. Also, economic research outside central banks, which is not driven by direct daily topics, proved ultimately valuable for policy too. For example, some ideas developed in Krugman in 1998 by Egerton and Woodford in 2003 on policy at the zero lower bound, inspired by the economic stagnation in Japan, well, eventually entered the United States and the euro-area policy debates years after their publication. The Banque de France Foundation has accompanied all these significant trends by fostering research conducted by international teams, by sponsoring research unrelated to immediate Banque de France needs, but which would ultimately prove beneficial for our policies. In that respect, I do expect that the foundation will still play an important role in the next decade in promoting excellence in research in the field of monetary and financial economics. And I also hope, and that will be my conclusion, that this is no wishful thinking either. Once again, very warm thanks to all the participants, the speakers, the discussants, and the chairs who have joined us today for such fruitful talks. And my personal congratulations for the young researchers who received the well-deserved prize for their work. And a final and very warm thank, a very special thank to all the actors of the foundations, all those who ensure the daily work of the foundation, also those who participate in its council, in its in the judgment of for the all the task of reading the paper, selecting the authors for the projects we finance, and that's very much appreciated. It's a constant help, a constant dedication. I'm really personally very grateful to all of you. Now it's time to have lunch, as Anna said. So I think also Buffett has been prepared. Thank you very much to all of you.